All right, I think I see the numbers slowing down a little bit in the Zoom room. So good afternoon, morning or evening to everyone, depending on where you're Zooming in from today. My name is Dana Dolanoy, and it's my distinct pleasure to welcome all of you today to this virtual symposium on innovations in relating real life exposures to chemical and chemical mixtures to on health outcomes. This symposium is sponsored by M-LEEaD, or the Michigan Center on Life Stage Environmental Exposures. And M-LEEaD is one of the National Institutes of Environmental Health Sciences core centers. These core centers are a network of scientists and community partners that seek to improve our understanding of the contribution of environmental exposures to the etiology of chronic diseases like asthma, neurodegenerative diseases, metabolic syndrome, and prematurity. To begin, I'd like to thank our M-LEEaD Center leadership, and in particular, M-LEEaD Associate Director Vasantha Punmanabhan and M-LEEaD affiliated scientists Deborah Watkins and Rebecca Petroff for organizing today's symposium. I'd also like to thank Michelle Dowd, Robin Wiley, and Meredith McGee for all of your planning and logistical support. And finally, I'd like to thank our speakers for sharing their expertise with us today, and thank you, our virtual audience, for your participation and interest in this important topic. Our symposium today will feature five speakers who will each focus on topics of real-life exposures and health outcomes, followed by a panel discussion at the end of this virtual event. To kick off the event, I'd like to introduce Dr. Deborah Watkins, Research Assistant Professor of Environmental Health Sciences. Dr. Watkins' research focuses on investigating causal relationships between exposure to contaminants during critical periods of development and subsequent health effects. She is also the chair of our department's Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee and is particularly interested in how disparate exposures to endocrine disrupting chemicals affect hormonally driven developmental processes such as growth, neurodevelopment, and puberty. Dr. Watkins?
All right, great. Thank you so much, Dana. And welcome everyone to our M-LEEaD symposium. Before I introduce our exciting lineup of speakers for this important topic, I'd like to go over some Zoom housekeeping. So since this is a webinar and we have a large number of attendees, your microphone and video have been turned off and will remain off during the event. If the meeting is disconnected, please stay in the meeting and Zoom should automatically reconnect you. For your best experience, please click the speaker window in the upper right corner of your Zoom window. This will allow you to see just the speaker. And if we have time for questions at the end of each talk will be 25 minutes followed by 5 minutes of questions. So feel free to leave your questions in the Q&A section. And Rebecca and I will collate them and then ask them of the speakers at the end of their talk. So today's speakers are Dr. Andreas Kortenkamp, a professor in human molecular toxicology at Brunel University in London, Dr. Jodi Flaws, who's a professor in comparative biosciences at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, Dr. Laura Vandenberg, who is an associate professor of environmental health sciences and associate dean for undergraduate studies at the University of Massachusetts Amherst and the School of Public Health and Health Sciences. Dr. Paul Fowler, who is a chair in translational medical sciences, director of the Institute of Medical Science at University of Aberdeen. And Dr. Jyotsna Jagai, who is a research assistant professor in the Division of Environmental and Occupational Health Sciences at the University of Illinois at Chicago. All right. And so then following our speakers, we will have 25 minutes for a panel of experts to provide policy, education, and technical perspectives, as well as guide our discussion based on the talks and questions from attendees. And our panelists for today are Dr. Jennifer McPartland, who is a senior scientist of the health program at the Environmental Defense Fund, Dr. Natalie Sampson, Associate Director of Environmental Health at UM Dearborn, and Dr. Zorimar Rivera-Núñez, who is Assistant Research Professor of Biostatistics and Epidemiology at Rutgers University. And so with that, I would like to turn it over to Dr. Kortenkamp for the first talk. I will stop sharing my screen So he should be able to share his. Dr. Kortenkamp is a professor, again, a professor in human molecular toxicology at Brunel University. The title of his talk today is Male Reproductive Health, a Bad Cocktail of Endocrine Disruptors. Dr. Kortenkamp's research focuses on the combined effects of mixtures of environmental pollutants on human health and wildlife, developing strategies for handling mixtures and chemicals regulation, and mechanisms of hormonal carcinogenesis. And so with that, the floor is yours, Dr. Kortenkamp.
Many thanks for this introduction, and many thanks for inviting me to participate in this symposium. I'd like to go back to the roots of endocrine disruptor research, which is male reproductive health. And in particular, I'd like to focus on declines in semen quality. It all started with this famous graph in 1992 in a paper by Carlson et al., who reported declines in sperm concentration in 5 decades from 1930 to the 1990s. This gave rise to considerable controversy, but the issue is settled now with this definitive systematic review of the matter by Levin et al., which appeared in 2017. You see a decline in sperm concentration from the 1930s to the 2010s. But this happens only in Western countries. The trend is unchanged after you control for age, abstinence, time, and smoking, and it's really not due to method changes over the years, because sperm concentration is basically determined by using hemocytometers. It's not only about semen quality. The wider implications of this are really rather serious. Poor semen quality is correlated with a higher risk of non-descending testes, cryptorchidism, also a higher risk of penile malformations called hyperspadia, where the urethra ends up on the underside of the penis and not at the top, and finally testis cancer. And it is hypothesized that all these disorders go back to insufficient androgen signaling in pregnancy. There's a good news. Men who frequently wear boxer shorts have considerably better semen quality. So what are the reasons for this considerable decline in semen quality? We know that body mass index, high body mass index plays a role. Also high meat consumption, full fat dairy products. So there's a rich nutritional epidemiological literature on this, and associations with all these factors have been shown. But what about chemical exposures? So the mission of my talk today is to bring the issues into focus from the perspective of mixture toxicology. So how do we assess combined exposures? Let me first convince you that it is possible to correctly anticipate the effects of multiple chemicals when we know their individual toxicity. We've published years ago a pathfinding experiment in collaboration with our colleagues in Copenhagen, the Denmark's Technical University. On the left, you see a number of dose-response relationships where pregnant rats were dosed with androgen receptor antagonists, vinclozolin, flutamide, prosimidone, and the male offspring was examined for changes in anogenital distance. You may know that this measure is used to sex rats. You can see from these graphs that dose escalation of each of these players can actually completely demasculinize the male offspring. At the higher doses, our colleagues in Copenhagen weren't able to tell whether this is now a female or a male rat. We use this information to make a prediction of the expected combined effects, here shown by the green curve in the bigger graph. The blue curve shows the regression model of the observed responses. To our amazement, it agreed extremely well with our prediction with the green curve. So we concluded that the combined effect of these three agents is essentially additive. This opens the door for mathematically anticipating the effect of rather large mixtures. There's another message in this experiment, which we call something from nothing. We could show that if you combine each individual chemical at doses, here shown in the upper panel by the vertical arrow, at doses not really associated with statistically significant responses, you get a halfway feminization between control males and control females. Here shown by the red bar to the right, the green bar shows the predicted effect. So there's a message for regulators that even at rather low levels, chemicals can act together to produce significant mixture effects. How can we translate these findings into something applicable to risk assessment practice? You may know from classical single chemical risk assessment the use of so-called risk quotients, which is the ratio of an intake to a reference dose, a reference dose being one defined as a tolerable or acceptable exposure. In single chemical risk assessment, we demand that this ratio must not exceed one. The mathematical prediction of experimental mixture effect means that we can simply extend this by demanding that the sum of risk quotients of all components in the mixture must not exceed one. Mathematically, it's the same algorithm. The assumptions behind this are that this algorithm, which we call dose addition, is a good approximation of observable mixture effects, and that there are no synergisms. The interpretation of these effects is important. It is not an estimation of an effect size. It rather tells us a fold exceedance of combined acceptable exposures. Now, the any mixture risk assessment begins with the question, which chemicals should be considered together? In our case, the selection criterion which we applied was it should affect semen quality. And ideally, we demanded that there should be evidence from human epidemiological studies or from animal studies. In some cases, this was difficult. We then reverted to effects that are part of the syndrome, which I showed you earlier. So decreases in hormone concentrations, changes in anogenital distance and the like. And finally, we considered exposures that happened during pregnancy and or childhood. These are critical, we know this, and often cause irreversible effects. So examples of chemicals that fall into these categories are the bisphenols, A, S, and F, polychlorinated dibenzodioxins. Here I show some photos from the catastrophic event in Seviso, Italy, 1976. Paracetamol is not widely known, but there are exposure of male fetuses at the end of the first trimester, beginning of the second trimester, leads to an increased risk of non-descending testes. Phthalates, well known for their antiandrogenic effects. So mixture risk assessment, how are we doing this in practice? So for each chemical in the mixture, we used exposure estimates from human biomonitoring studies or from food consumption estimates. We applied reference doses for declines in semen quality or related effects. And the results I'm going to show you are mostly based on European exposures, usually at the 95th percentile, which is normal to use in risk assessments of this kind. So this is how it works. for chemicals. So here I show in the column exposure estimates in microgram per kilogram body weight and day. We have our reference dose for declines in skin quality. And from that, you build a risk quotient by dividing exposure by reference dose. And here is the result of our mixture risk assessment. To the left, you see the outcome of lower bound exposure estimates. To the right, the upper bound estimate. What is immediately apparent is that the sum of risk quotients very strongly exceeds one, here highlighted by the vertical red line. What is also apparent is here highlighted by the red circle, that a number of chemicals contribute disproportionately to the sum of risk quotients. It varies the rank order a little whether we consider lower bound or upper bound estimates, but what is important is to note is that the bad five, as I'd like to call them, dioxins, bisphenol A, paracetamol, or in the US you call this substance acetaminophen. This is an analgesic. Bisphenol F and BDE-99, which is a brominated flame retardant, explain more than 95% of combined exceedance of tolerable exposure. What is striking, and this surprised us very much, is that substances that are the focus of public attention, for example, phthalates or pesticides of a certain nature, hardly matter. So the mixture perspective, which we adopted here, really focuses the mind and tells us something about a rank order of priorities. So the other important message of our analysis is that even if we targeted the dirty five, the sum of risk quotients would still be larger than one. And I have to qualify my analysis here. We haven't yet analyzed other potential contributors like polychlorinated biphenyls or triclosan and other chemicals. What does it mean when sum of risk quotients exceeds one by 20 to 30 fold? What this means in terms of risk along the y-axis of a chart like this depends entirely on the positioning and the gradient of the underlying dose-response relationships, which we do not know how this plays out in the human, and perhaps this is unknowable. Two scenarios. On the left, we show an example where this leads to significant declines in semen quality. On the right, a situation where the effect is rather smaller. You see how it depends on the positioning of this curve. To introduce you to some uncertainties which are inherent in our analysis, the hazard data about bisphenol F are, we rate them as low confidence, as of low confidence. That is just the situation at the moment with experimental work in this area. There are incomplete data about the polybrominated flame retardants. Some of the PBDE congeners are missing and data are not available. Same applies to polychlorinated biphenyls. The other important question is whether exposure to all these chemicals really happens at the same time. The exposure estimates we based our analysis on are from separate people. We don't have any data measured where this set of pollutants is measured in one and the same individual at the same time. This is a limitation of the general exposure assessment. Now, I'd like to unpack a couple of reference doses for these chemicals. For bisphenol A, we had to conduct a systematic review of animal studies in order to derive a reference dose for these effects, which is 0.01 microgram per kilogram a day. This is about to be published. the estimated tolerable dose ranges from animal studies agree rather well, strikingly well, with evidence from epidemiological studies, which I have to stress is mostly for exposures in adult life, not in fetal life. But our reference value is 0.01 microgram per kilogram a day. That's the value we used for this analysis. And you see here the daily intakes, the ranges associated in six epidemiological studies with declines in semen quality. So ballpark figure-wise, there's good agreement. The exposure in European populations to bisphenol A based on biomonitoring studies is currently tenfold higher, 0.1 microgram per kilogram a day. Our reference dose for dioxins is taken from a new document by the European Food Safety Authority, which re-evaluated tolerable exposures for PCDDs. The value we took is exactly the same as in this document published in 2019, and this comes from epidemiological studies of the Russian children cohort. Paracetamol is an interesting case. The evidence we have is very shaky there, although the more evidence we will have, the more scary it will become, I fear. Here's a recent study by Rossito et al. Where they administered paracetamol to pregnant rats and observed purely matured Sertoli cells in the offspring. You may remember that Sertoli cells are the nourishing cells of spermatocytes. So this is rather important. So at this level, 30 milligram per kilogram paracetamol, that's the dose they applied to the rodents, there was a clear effect. The maximum therapeutic dose for paracetamol acetaminophen is between 6 and 7 milligram per kilogram body weight. The dose associated with effects in mice is 30, so this is really effects. That margin of exposure is too small, so we estimated a risk quotient of 2. Let us link back to the nutritional epidemiology. I've photographed some food items which contribute disproportionately to our bisphenol A and F exposure. Bisphenol A, a lot comes from milk. This is true for Europe. Maybe it's the same in the USA. From tinned tomatoes, from tinned fish, and from mustard, especially that is true for bisphenol F. We know that from the traditional epidemiology that high consumption of meat, of dairy produce and fatty foods is associated with poor semen quality. And our chemical analysis, our mixture risk assessment, interestingly parallels these insights. We've highlighted bisphenol A, dioxins, PBDB as contributing disproportionately to mixture risk, and that somehow aligns with the nutritional epidemiology. This warrants further analysis. I'd like to thank you for your attention and acknowledge the contributions of my collaborators, Sibylle Ermler, Alwyn Martin, and Martin Schulze at Brunel University. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Kortenkamp. We do have one question coming in through the Q&A. If you do have any questions at all, please feel free to put them in the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So this question says, could the minimal association of phthalates to the mixture effect on sperm decline be due to the rapid clearing of phthalates compared to the other exposures measured?
The straightforward answer is no. It's a simple no, because this clearance stuff, any pharmacokinetic stuff, doesn't come in at this level of our analysis. So this is already taken care of. It's simply due to the fact that the reference dose for this kind of effect you can estimate for phthalates is relatively high or higher then the combined exposure levels to phthalates at the moment, at this present time in Europe.
Do you think that where exposure to phthalates is higher, that it would make a difference, or is that not?
Yes, it might make a difference, yes. But what I'm referring to here is very recent exposure data in Europe for phthalates. They're pretty rock solid and based on human biomonitoring studies, time trends worth over 27 years. Mainly German data.
Okay. All right, I have another question. A while back, some risk assessment guidance suggesting adding only if the mode of action or target was similar. Do you have thoughts on that?
Oh, yes, I have many thoughts on that. That is... The thinking about mode of action in mixture risk assessment, I'm afraid, has been contaminated very much by earlier efforts of US EPA. So in some people's minds, mixture effects cannot arise if the players in the mixture don't hit the exact same molecular target. That is actually not borne out by experimental evidence, especially in the area of male reproductive health, animal experimentation. We have direct empirical evidence that chemicals with very different modes of action, say antagonizing the androgen receptor, driving down testosterone synthesis, interfering with prostaglandin signaling, which is relevant to analgesics, can work together to produce the same adverse outcome. So this can be rationalized by thinking in terms of adverse outcome networks, adverse outcome pathway networks, where various effector chains and signaling pathways converge on common nodes and then trigger common adverse outcomes downstream. So to be very precise, if we adopted a very restrictive mode of action inspired perspective on mixture risk assessment, we would only capture a fraction of the combined risks.
All right. I think that answers actually a couple of questions that we have here. Okay. I have another comment. Thanks for the great presentation. I have a question about PFAS. Is there any study on mixture risk assessment of PFAS?
There are maybe some. We've done some in vitro work with PFAS. PFAS in vitro are fairly weak antagonists of the androgen receptor, and we put it in some of our mixtures. That paper is published. Thank you for drawing attention to PFAS. We're currently very busy unearthing useful data useful for this analysis about PFAS. There are indications that they also are associated with declines in semen quality, but as far as I know now, the data are of insufficient quality to stick into our analysis.
Okay.
Let me also, on that note, let me stress that the rank order of risk quotients, so the rank order of big hitters, is very sensitive to the kind of chemicals you include in your analysis. And I tried to stress this during my talk. There are uncertainties. Very likely the risk estimates I've shown you tonight or today, this lunchtime, are an underestimate, because we know of many chemicals that potentially also contribute to this, but we have insufficient quantitative data to come up with meaningful risk quotients.
Right. And a question, if the example of something from nothing is more widespread than just the example you give, would not the sum of hazard quotients underestimate the likely total impact?
The sum of hazard, mathematically, no. Sum of hazard quotients can capture this something from nothing, because you can easily add up hazard quotients. They should actually be called risk quotients, that are smaller than one. There's no problem with that. So that would capture the something from nothing phenomenon.
Okay. All right, I think we have time for a couple more. Person says, thanks for the nice talk. I do believe I have earlier heard you talk about pesticides eliciting 7 out of 10 responses on androgen assays. Am I remembering wrong?
You may have heard me talk about pesticides, yes, but these were in vitro studies. We've used many pesticides in our in vitro experiments. These were mainly designed to explore the accurate predictability of mixture effects in these systems by using the algorithm of dose addition, which mathematically means you add up these risk quotients.
Okay.
But at the moment, based on the evidence of pesticide exposures to in Europe to the general population, this doesn't include occupationally exposed people. The risk quotients we can detect are rather low.
Okay.
By the way, this should not be misunderstood. I'm not arguing that pesticides are harmless. I'm presenting an analysis with respect to male semen quality. These analyses are sensitive to the endpoint, the toxicity endpoint you consider, and the story may change entirely if you start beginning to consider developmental neurotoxicity or other forms of toxicity. I'd like to stress that to avoid misunderstandings.
Got it. And I think someone said in, there was a comment here and then it disappeared. Or is it just that the PCDD and the paracetamol effects are just so much stronger as well? So it's not just different outcomes, but also...
Yeah. The risk quotient is always a composite measure of exposure and toxic potency. And without a doubt, the dioxins are very potent. So that's the reason why they're still part of the dirty five.
All right, I think one more question. Does low sperm quality lead to more birth defects, or does the low quality sperm simply have a lower efficacy rate at producing a pregnancy?
The latter. And as I said at the beginning of my talk, the concern we have there is the relation to the other male reproductive disorder, non-descending testes, penile malformations, and in particular, testis cancer. In Europe, I don't know about the US, but in Europe, we're currently experiencing a testis cancer epidemic. What's frightening is that countries not previously on the map for that, the European high-risk countries, the Scandinavian countries, new countries are entering the fray, especially in the south of Europe, which is really rather scary, I have to say. Testis cancer is treatable. You won't, in all likelihood, die from it, but it is a burden to the health system and an absolute burden to the individuals concerned. It is truly frightening.
Okay. Well, actually, I see one more. Are there adequate in vitro bioassays to test mixtures, especially for chemicals without food consumption or biomonitoring data?
Well, that depends on the endpoint captured in an in vitro assay. We have published multiple papers on using androgen receptor reporter gene assays, and that works fine. The largest mixture we've tested using these assays is a 35-component mixture. It was a lot of work, but we've shown this is possible to still, with that large number of chemicals, to accurately predict mixture effects.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Excellent talk. And so now I'm going to hand it off to Rebecca to introduce our next speaker.
Thank you. I have the pleasure today of introducing Dr. Jodi Flaws, who is a professor in comparative biosciences at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And today, Dr. Flaws is going to talk about her talk here entitled Applying Real-Life Phthalate Mixtures from an Illinois Pregnancy Cohort to toxicological models, excuse me. And Dr. Flaws has a very robust research program that's focused on determining the mechanism by which environmental chemicals affect the development and function of the ovary and female reproduction using both human and mouse models. Dr. Flaws?
Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. And I really want to thank the organizers for inviting me to share some of our work. I'm thrilled to be here. What I want to do in my talk today is first give some background on the chemicals that we work on in my lab called phthalates, and really specifically focus on a phthalate mixture that we've been using. And then I'll share with you some of our data on the effects of this phthalate mixture on ovarian follicles in vitro, telling you our hypotheses, a little bit about our experimental design, and sharing some data. And then I want to move from in vitro to how we've used this mixture in vivo and tell you about some of our studies on the effects of prenatal phthalate exposure on the ovary and sex steroid hormones in the F1 generation of mice. And again, I'll share our hypotheses, experimental design, and data, and then leave you with some conclusions. So first, just a little background on what are phthalates. Phthalates are chemicals that are commonly used as plasticizers and additives in a wide variety of products. They're present in food and beverage containers, children's toys, building materials such as PVC piping. They're used in baby wipes and other wipes. They're used in perfumes and colognes, heavily used in personal care products such as lotions, shampoos, and conditioners. And they're also a component of IV tubing and medical blood bags. So there's near ubiquitous exposure to phthalates, and I want to give a little background on why we are concerned about this exposure. First of all, phthalates have been detected in virtually 100% of human fluids and tissues. We know that men, women, and children are all exposed to phthalates pretty much daily, all day long. We also know that there tends to be a higher exposure in children than adults, in part because of the exposure through children's toys. We also know that women tend to have higher exposure than men, and this is likely due to the fact that women tend to use more personal care products than men. Several studies, including the NHANES study, estimate that people have greater than 13 phthalates in their bodies at all times. The serum levels of one single phthalate can get up to 450 nanograms per mil, and the single phthalate can be 250 micrograms per kilogram body weight per day. Now, we're also concerned with phthalates because they have been associated with human health risks in several epidemiologic studies. These studies show that phthalate exposure is associated with high blood pressure, increased insulin resistance, pregnancy loss, preterm birth, decreased sex steroid hormone levels, as well as fertility problems. Similarly, many studies have shown adverse effects in animal models. We know that phthalates can affect body weight. Sometimes the phthalates are obesogenic. It depends on the phthalate and the dose. Other times, the phthalates will cause weight loss in animal models. We know that phthalates can disrupt development of the reproductive organs, disrupt the onset of puberty, and like in women and men, it can reduce fertility. Now, one thing that I want to note is that most previous studies on phthalates really focus on one single phthalate at a time, particularly in the animal studies. And these studies are incredibly important because they do tell us about the toxicity of a single phthalate. However, it's recognized, as mentioned by the first speaker, that humans are exposed to mixtures of chemicals, including mixtures of phthalates. And when we started to look in the literature about what was known about mixtures of phthalates and their impact on reproductive health, we found that there was very limited information available. In some studies, particularly the animal studies I'm talking about here, there were mixture studies being done that may not be relevant to human exposure. Oftentimes, these mixtures included phthalates, but they also included lots of other chemicals that people would not be exposed to at the same time as phthalates. And probably the biggest issue was that a lot of the mixture studies, the basic science studies, were using very high doses of mixtures, doses that nobody would ever see in an environmentally relevant fashion. And even among studies where they did use appropriate mixtures and relevant doses, there really was a lack of information on the effect of these mixtures on female reproduction. So my lab really became interested in is studying an environmentally relevant mixture of phthalates at appropriate doses and looking at the impact on the female reproductive system. Now, to come up with what we thought was an environmentally relevant phthalate mixture, we wanted to base it on human studies. And what we did is we based our phthalate mixture on the levels of phthalates that were being measured in an epidemiological study being conducted here at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign by Dr. Susan Shantz. And this study is called the iKid study. And in Dr. Shantz's study, they are enrolling pregnant women, monitoring urinary metabolites of phthalates, and to get an estimate of exposure to phthalates, and then looking at the offspring and correlating mom's exposure to phthalates with outcomes in the offspring. And so what we wanted to do was make a mixture that mimicked what Sue was seeing in her study as far as exposure in pregnant women. And what Sue's study, iKids, was showing is that the women were largely being exposed to six different phthalates. And I've listed them here. They're DEP, DEHP, DBP, DINP, DIBP, and BBZP. And the other thing that the iKids study told us was that these phthalates were in certain proportions in the population, in the cohort that Sue was studying. And that roughly 35% of the phthalate exposure was coming from DEP, 21% from DEHP, roughly 15% from these two phthalates, and then a bit less from DIBP and BZBP. So in considering making our mixture for our animal studies, we wanted to have a mixture that had these six phthalates because we knew that these are what people in the iKids study were being exposed to. And we wanted them to be at these relative proportions so that we could mimic the relative proportion of human exposure. The next thing we wanted to do was try to make sure that our doses were relevant to what was being reported in epidemiologic studies. And so this is a table here where I've listed the different phthalates. Here's our six phthalates. This is the percentage that they are in the mixture. So if you first focus on DEP here, that's 35% of our mixture. If we dose animals with a mixture that is a 20 microgram per kilogram dose of the mixture, 35% of 20 micrograms is 7 micrograms. So we know in our mixture there are 7 micrograms of DEP. And if we scale this up and dose with 10 times as much, we know that there are 70 micrograms. Now, we looked at data from lots of human studies, and this is a summary where those studies were looking at the median estimate microgram per kilogram per day exposure in pregnant women, as well as the maximum. So the median in human populations was about 6.6, and the maximum was 1,263. And so if you look at our doses, our micrograms that are in the doses we give, they are within this human range. And so most of our phthalates here in the mixture pretty well correlate with what is being reported as far as exposure in the human population. So we felt like we had a mixture that was environmentally relevant and that we could tailor our doses to mimic what is thought to be the median exposure in women. And one of the first things we wanted to do was look to see whether this mixture had any biological effects. And we were really focused initially on the ovary, and we wanted to start our studies in vitro to see if we saw any initial effects before we embarked on some larger in vivo studies. And what I want to do is share with you some of our in vitro data. And in these data that I'm going to show you, we're really focused on a structure in the ovary called the antral follicle. This is the most mature follicle type in the ovary. It contains an oocyte, granulosa cells, and fecal cells. Now, these antral follicles are the only follicles that are capable of ovulating and releasing oocytes for fertilization. So the health of these follicles is absolutely critical for fertility. A second major important function of these antral follicles is that they synthesize and secrete sex steroid hormones, estrogens, androgens, and progesterones. These hormones are absolutely required to maintain the reproductive tract, allow normal development of the eggs, allow implantation, regulate menstrual and estrous cyclicity, required for fertility, and estrogens coming from the antral follicle and the ovary in general are really critical for female health because they are essential for cardiovascular, brain, and bone health. So given this background, the first hypothesis that we had was that the phthalate mixture exposure decreases antral follicle growth, induces atresia, which is death of antral follicles, and reduces steroidogenic capacity. To test this hypothesis, we use an outbred strain of mice called CD1 mice. We isolate the ovaries from the mice, and then from each ovary, we can isolate individual antral follicles. And then we can plate each antral follicle in a 96 well in a culture plate, and then individually treat follicles with either vehicle control, which in this case is dimethyl sulfoxide or DMSO, or various doses of our phthalate mixture. Now, the nice thing about our culture system is that during culture, we can monitor the growth of the antral follicle by measuring its size under a microscope and perpendicular axes. We can collect these follicles at various times in culture and subject them to quantitative PCR to measure regulators of follicle growth, health, and death. And I'm going to share with you some data looking at regulators of apoptosis, the cell cycle, and steroidogenesis. We can also collect these follicles and embed them in plastic for histology and assess the morphology and the health of the follicles histologically. And finally, we can collect media from these cultures and use enzyme-linked immunoadsorbent assays to measure the levels of estrogens, androgens, and progesterone. So I first want to share with you our data looking at the effect of this mixture on follicle growth. This graph here is showing the percent change in growth over time, and we culture for up to 96 hours, and our DMSO groups and our different treatment groups. If you first focus on the orange line, that's our control. What the data show is that after about 48 hours in culture, those follicles rapidly grow and continue to grow throughout the culture. Similarly, our two lower doses of the phthalate mixture, after about 48 hours, they grow very similar to the control. However, if you look at our 100 microgram per milliliter dose, that dose of mixture significantly inhibits growth compared to control. And finally, our highest dose completely ablates growth. And in fact, those follicles do not grow at all compared to control. So follicles can stop growing for a couple of reasons. One of them is that maybe the mixture is killing the follicles. The other alternative hypothesis is maybe the mixture is not allowing those granulosa cells or thecal cells in the follicle to proliferate so that they cannot grow. So we wanted to assess both of these possibilities. So I'm first going to show you our data looking at the effect of this mixture on atresia or death of follicles. And I'm showing two example follicles here, our control treated follicle and our lowest dose of the mixture. And we histologically evaluate these follicles and stain them so that we could see apoptotic or dying cells. So this is a control follicle. This is an oocyte. These are granulosa cells, and this is a fecal cell. And I've circled here some of the cells that are dying granulosa cells. And then this is from the 10 microgram per milliliter mixture group. Again, here's the oocyte, granulosa cells, and fecal cells. One of the things that visually we started to notice is that it actually seemed contrary to our hypothesis that the mixture-treated follicles looked healthier than the control-treated follicles. And so what we wanted to do was quantify this to make sure that it was correct. So we quantified this without knowledge of treatment group, and we assigned the follicles different atresia scores. So a 1 would mean less than 3% of the cells were dying, a 2, 4 to 10% were dying, a 3, 11 to 14% were dying, and four more than 30% were dying. And when we did this, I'm showing you the data here. So this is the atresia score. And remember, the higher the score, the more death, and our various treatment groups, control, and then our different doses. And what the quantification showed us was that the three highest treatment groups had significantly less atresia or dying cells compared to control. So these data do not explain why our follicles were not growing. It's not that they're not growing because they're dying. They're actually dying less than our control follicles. So what we wanted to do was look at this alternative possibility that maybe they weren't dying, but maybe they weren't growing because they're not proliferating and cells are not progressing through the cell cycle. So I don't have time to show you all of our data, so I've summarized it here. And this is looking at the effect of the mixture on the cell cycle. So as cells proliferate, they go through a generic cycle where they progress from the G1 through the S, through the G2, through the M phase. And I've put on the outside of this cycle the different regulators of these different phases. One of the things that we found was that the mixture-treated follicles had reduced expressions of factors such as cyclin D, cyclin E, and CDK4, which are important for progression or promotion of the cell cycle through the G1 phase. We also found that this mixture significantly increased expression of CDKN2A, which is a cell cycle inhibitor. And so what we think is happening is that the mixture is inhibiting expression of factors that regulate promotion through the cell cycle and upregulating expression of factors that inhibit the cell cycle. So the bottom line is that these follicles, the cells in the follicles, cannot proliferate, and thus the follicles cannot grow. And it's very common, at least in the ovary, that some endocrine disrupting chemicals could sort of suspend the cells so they don't die and they don't proliferate and they just sort of sit there. And we think the reason we're not getting follicle growth is because the follicles are not dying and they're not growing. They're just suspended in this animated state and halted in the cell cycle. Now, one thing I want to mention is that in addition to the proliferation of the granulosa cells and apoptosis of the granulosa cells being altered, when we look at the oocyte in these follicles, it's very damaged. So this is an example of a mixture-treated follicle. Here's granulosa cells. This is the oocyte, and it's been fragmented into three spaces. This is another oocyte from a mixture-treated culture, where there is a lot of fragmentation. Here's an oocyte with tons of fragmentation. We never saw this fragmentation in any of the control-treated follicles. In addition, if the oocyte wasn't fragmented, a lot of the mixture-treated follicles, the oocytes had holes in them, like shown in these two examples. And again, we never saw these kind of holes in our control-treated follicles. And finally, as I mentioned, we collected media from these cultured follicles, and we looked at the effects of the mixture on steroidogenesis. And I'm showing examples here of the effect of the mixture on androstenedione and testosterone, which are two androgens, estrone and estradiol, which are two estrogens. And all of these graphs, I've got the amount of hormone on the y-axis and our treatment groups on the x-axis. And what our data show is that the mixture significantly inhibited production of androstenedione compared to control, inhibited testosterone compared to control, inhibited estrone compared to control, and inhibited estradiol compared to control. So I just want to summarize here what I've told you so far about our results of this effect of the mixture in vitro. So if we have an antral follicle and we directly expose it to the phthalate mixture, that phthalate mixture causes cell cycle arrest and inhibits apoptosis so that the cells in the follicles are sort of suspended in a state where they don't grow. Now, I didn't have time to show you these data, but we have lots of data also showing that the mixture inhibits the expression of key enzymes that are required to make sex steroid hormones. And it inhibits expression of receptors in the ovary that are critical also for making sex steroid hormones. And so the combination of inhibiting the ability of the follicle to make sex steroid hormones, and particularly hormones that are important for follicle growth, is leading to the reduced follicle growth and steroidogenesis. Now, because we have seen some effects of this mixture in vitro, we next wanted to see if there would be effects if we did an in vivo animal study. And so the hypothesis that we tested was that prenatal exposure to an environmentally relevant phthalate mixture adversely affects female reproductive outcomes in mice. And the reason that we chose this kind of setup where we're doing prenatal exposure and looking at outcomes in the female offspring is because we wanted to mimic what Dr. Shantz was doing in the iKids study, where she's studying pregnant women and their exposure to phthalates, and then looking at their offspring. Now, our experimental design was basically to take the phthalate mixture of our six different phthalates, expose pregnant dams to that mixture, and then look at reproductive outcomes in her female offspring. Now, this schematic just gives a little bit more detail of our experimental design. We started dosing from embryonic day 10 and a half, and the study ended when the offspring were 13 months of age. We dosed animals between pregnant dams between embryonic day 10 and a half until birth, because this is a critical developmental period for development of the female reproductive tract. The mice were orally dosed with either tocopherol strip corn oil or one of four doses of our mixture. After birth, there was no more dosing, and we then collected tissue from the offspring and assessed the tissue at various times from postnatal day one through 13 months of age. And what I'm going to share with you today is some of our data from animals that were 13 months of age. Keep in mind that these animals were prenatally exposed, and this is over a year after their birth and exposure. And in these animals, we monitored estrocyclicity, ovarian histology, hormone levels, including estradiol, progesterone, and testosterone. So first I'll share with you the data on the effect of this mixture exposure on F1 cyclicity at 3 months. So mice have four-day estrus cycles, proestrus, estrus, metestrus, and diestrus. Metestrus and diestrus in mice are identical, so we usually lump them together for analysis. And this is the percentage of days that the mice spend at each of these times in the cycle, and our control and our different treatment groups. And what our data showed is that at 3 months of age, the F1 offspring spent more time in estrus and less time in metestrus and diestrus in the mixture-treated groups compared to control. Interestingly, when we assess cyclicity when these animals were 13 months of age, which is quite old actually for a mouse, this is really towards the end of reproductive capacity, we did not see any significant difference between control and the mixtures and any of the time that the animal spent in each stage of the estrus cycle. Now, when we assessed ovarian histology, we look at different follicle numbers in the ovary, and the ovary has follicles called primordial, primary, preantral, and antral follicles. And this is showing the number of follicles in control and the different treatment groups. And we did not see any significant effects on numbers of follicles in the mixture-treated animals versus control. I do want to make a comment here that this is absolute numbers. We have not yet finished assessing whether the mixture is affecting proliferation of the cells in the follicles or death of the cells in the follicles as we did in vitro. One thing I want to point out is that many of the ovaries, even though we didn't see differences in follicle numbers, they were quite abnormal. So this is a mouse uterus. And this is what a normal mouse ovary looks like. This is a mouse ovary that's very abnormal, in fact, very cystic. And we noticed a lot of our mixture exposed animals had very cystic ovaries. In fact, we never saw these cysts in any of the control animals, but up to 78% of our mixture treated animals had cysts in the ovary. Now, when we looked at circulating levels of estradiol in the females, this is the levels of estradiol in our different treatment groups. We did not see any effect of the mixture compared to control on estradiol. Similarly, the mixture did not affect progesterone levels compared to control. However, we do see that the mixture significantly reduced testosterone levels, especially at these two higher doses compared to control. So to summarize what I've told you about our in vivo results, if pregnant dams are exposed to our phthalate mixture and we look in her offspring at 13 months of age, up to 13 months of age, I showed you that these mixture exposed animals have disrupted estrocyclicity at 3 months of age. There are no or minor effects on follicle numbers. The mixture induced cystic ovaries and reduced testosterone levels. So what I'd like to conclude by saying is that this environmentally relevant phthalate mixture has both in vivo and in vitro effects. In vitro, we've shown that this mixture can slow follicle growth, decrease production of sex steroid hormones, and cause fragmentation of the oocytes. In vivo, this phthalate mixture and the F1 generation that was prenatally exposed can alter estrocyclicity, decrease testosterone levels, and increase ovarian cysts. So I'd really like to acknowledge my wonderful lab who has contributed in many aspects of this project. In particular, I'd like to acknowledge Emily Brem, who's a fantastic PhD student in my lab, who did all of the in vivo work that I shared with you, and Dr. CQ Joe, who was a former PhD student in my lab, who as part of her dissertation did the in vitro work that I shared with you. And I would like to thank our funding sources and all of you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Flaws. We just have a couple minutes here for maybe one or two quick questions. So I'll start out with one that says, if you compare equimolar concentrations of phthalate mixture versus individual phthalate, do you know if the effects were additive or is there any evidence for synergy?
Yes, yeah, so we haven't gotten that far yet. We have compared DEHP alone versus the mixture. And what I can tell you is that some of the effects we're seeing are the same. Some of them are very different, but we haven't done individually a lot of the other phthalates yet to be able to get at this additive versus synergistic. But that's where we're hoping to go. Particularly, we're going to do a lot of that in vitro because we have a nice system where it's easy to test.
Thank you so much. Just very briefly, have you conducted any predictive modeling of the individual phthalate data on the endpoints measured either in vitro or in vivo? The commenter here says it would be interesting to know whether DEP exposure contributed to the effect.
Yeah, no, that's great. We haven't done that yet, but that's certainly one of the areas we're hoping to get into and look at that.
Okay, with time in mind, I'm going to pass it back to Deb and thank Dr. Flaws once more for her great talk. And hopefully we'll get a little bit more time to talk here at the end about what some of these presentations means. I'd also like to mention that we are recording this. So just so everyone knows, we will have a recording posted in a little while after this afternoon once we finish the captioning on it. So thanks, and Deb, go ahead.
All right. Thank you. All right, so our next speaker is Dr. Laura Vandenberg. I don't know if Laura, if you would like to share your slides. Dr. Vandenberg is an associate professor of environmental health sciences and associate dean for undergraduate studies at UMass Amherst School of Public Health and Health Sciences. The title of her talk is "The Mammary Gland is a Sensitive Organ, Lessons Learned from Fracking Chemical Mixtures." Dr. Vandenberg's research examines the effects of endocrine disrupting chemicals on function and disease of the mammary gland and on maternal behaviors. Outside of the lab, her research critically evaluates issues that affect risk and hazard assessments for endocrine disrupting chemicals, including low dose effects, non-monotonic dose responses, and methods used to evaluate chemical hazards. And it's all yours.
Great, thank you. And I have just loved listening to these talks this afternoon. It's afternoon where I am. I also want to thank the organizers for asking me to be here. And I also want to start with the end, which is thanking the folks who really were responsible for the conception of this project and support for this project, and also doing a lot of the work. So as you'll hear, this is a project that really originated in Dr. Susan Nagel's lab at University of Missouri, and really was spearheaded by her then PhD student, Chris Kasotis, who I believe is on the call today. And you could tell how much time has now passed because Chris just started a faculty position at Wayne State. And I also want to acknowledge the leadership of Theo Colborne, to thinking about the chemicals that are found in fracking wastewater and are used in fracking, and the support that she gave to Susan's lab in conceptualizing this project. And finally, I'll thank Sarah Sapowski, who was actually a really fantastic honors student in my lab as an undergraduate, and now has moved on, is at the University of Iowa, where she recently defended her PhD. She's incredibly exceptional. So I have the great opportunity to present to you about a real environmental challenge, which comes from unconventional oil and gas extraction. And one way that oil and gas are extracted is through the concept of fracking. This is shorthand for hydraulic fracturing. And in the process of collecting oil and gas, usually it's gas from underground pockets, it requires the pumping of high pressure water, which usually contains a mixture of water, sand, and chemicals, down into pipes for the purposes of creating a lot of pressure down there and releasing natural gas out of natural pockets. And one of the things that you'll find if you start to read about the chemicals that are involved in fracking is that more than 90% of what goes into these fracking wells is water, and somewhere between 7 and 9% of what goes down is sand, which means that usually less than 1% and up to 2% of what gets injected into these wells is chemical makeup. And that is supposed to make us feel better about it, that the vast majority of what goes into these wells is just water. But because the number of these wells and the volume of water that's used to inject into them is so huge, we're really talking about tons, hundreds of tons of chemicals that are injected into the ground for hydraulic fracturing really every year. And a lot of what I'm going to tell you today really focuses on the idea of how little we know about what the actual chemical mixtures are. And you'll see that I use this, this abbreviation for unconventional oil and gas mixtures throughout my talk. And this is one of the challenges, is trying to create a mixture that truly is environmentally relevant. And then the question is, relevant to whom? Because each of the organizations that's involved in unconventional oil and gas is using its own proprietary mixture. So what might be true at one fracking site is not necessarily going to be true at another. A lot of attention was given to chemicals that are used in fracking in the early 2000s. And I love this quote that's from really a summary of the work of Theo Colborne and her contribution to studies of the chemicals used in fracking. Really in the early 2000s, the oil and gas industry was claiming that the only things that were being injected into fracking wells was soap, water, and guar gum. And the problem was that people who were living in communities where fracking was suddenly a booming industry were reporting very different experiences. They were reporting smells, they were reporting flammable water. What Theo Colborne and her colleagues did is to start to collect the safety data sheets that were available at those fracking sites, and realizing that the chemicals that were being reported for occupational hazard purposes were much more extensive than just soap, water, and guar gum. And so in 2011, Theo and her colleagues published the first real database through her organization, the Endocrine Disruptor Exchange. And what they did is they looked at what had been reported to be used at fracking sites. There were 944 products that collectively included more than 600 chemicals that were reported for use at fracking sites. And more than 350 of these had documented effects in the literature that would suggest that they might harm health. Of those 353 chemicals that had hazard data available, 75% had been shown to possibly have effects on skin, eyes, other sensory organs, the respiratory system, and or the gastrointestinal tract. 40% had been reported to cause toxicity in brain and other neurodevelopmental outcomes, immune outcomes, and cardiovascular health. And 37% had been reported to have effects on the endocrine system. And these might be chemicals that we think of very broadly as endocrine disrupting chemicals. And I'll use the definition that's the broadest definition of an endocrine disrupting chemical that is used by the Endocrine Society, which are chemicals that interfere in one or more of the actions of hormones. So in this way, endocrine disrupting chemicals could be chemicals that mimic endogenous hormones, chemicals that block endogenous hormones, but also chemicals that interfere in some way with the synthesis, the secretion, the metabolism of hormones in the body. And these are the class of chemicals that I'm really interested in. And of course, Theo, as the leader of the Endocrine Disruptor Exchange, this was also the class of chemicals that she had grave concerns about. So in order to start to narrow down chemicals that are used at fracking sites that might be of interest, Susan Nagel's lab went and started to do some evaluations of what are those chemicals, what are those chemicals that have been reported to have endocrine disrupting chemicals or properties, and what are they being used for? And Susan and her team identified 24 chemicals that they wanted to study in more depth. And they were going to study these first one at a time and then create a mixture. And I'm showing you over here on the right-hand side, not the identity of the chemicals, I'll show you some of those in a minute, but really what they're reported to be used for in that fracking mixture. So they're meant to improve the quality of that fracking mixture, which again is 90% water, about 8% sand, and then the last 2% comprised of chemicals that are meant to kill bacteria, that are meant to act as surfactants so that you get a more slippery surface, that are meant to prevent foaming from occurring. So these chemicals are added for real purposes. And this is the list of 23 of the chemicals that Susan, Chris Kasotis, and their team evaluated that had been reported in safety data sheets as used at fracking sites. And the very first thing that they did was to evaluate them in cell culture experiments and screen them for receptor antagonist activity. So these would be consistent with blocking of estrogen receptor behavior, androgen receptor behavior, progesterone receptor behavior, the thyroid hormone, and the glucocorticoid receptor. So you can see that some of these chemicals have a lot of behaviors in these screening assays versus others had none. And importantly, one of the things that I think is really critical is that there weren't analytical standards available for all of those chemicals, but of the ones that were available, Chris Kasotis sampled from wastewater that was collected at fracking sites and detected measurable levels of 16 of those chemicals. So the important thing is, in contrast to the talks that we've heard today from Dr. Kortenkamp and from Dr. Flaws, the attempt was not necessarily made to mix these chemicals in a mixture at concentrations relevant to what had been detected in the environment, again, because different sites reported different amounts and different companies used different proprietary mixtures at their fracking sites. The chemicals were also not picked based on the levels that had previously been shown to have effects in vivo. So they were mixed in equal concentrations. And again, there was a mixture created of 23 commonly used chemicals reported from unconventional oil and gas operations. And that 23 chemical mixture was administered to pregnant female mice from pregnancy day 11 until the day that they gave birth. And at increasing concentrations in the drinking water, which Chris and Susan estimated to be 330, 300, or 3,000 micrograms per kilogram per day of each individual chemical. And then the offspring were evaluated really at two different periods of postnatal life. First, at the period leading up to puberty, and then in early adulthood. And Chris's analyses really started first with evaluating the effects that were seen on the male offspring. And he reported significant effects on sperm count, on weight of the reproductive organs, as well as body weight, on weight of the heart and the thymus, as well as on serum testosterone levels. The second study that was conducted in the female offspring found that there were significant effects on pituitary hormones, on the weight of organs like the ovary and the heart, as well as on histopathology of the heart, changes to body weight, and then also changes to those ovarian follicles that you just heard about from Dr. Flaws. What's really interesting is that if we think about the reproductive signaling axis, the endocrine axis, the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian axis that's functional in females, where the biggest effect was seen was on the concentrations of hormones that are produced by the pituitary, including LH and FSH. And Chris reported that these hormones were decreased in females that had been exposed during early development. There were also decreases in sex hormones, including estradiol, although they were not significantly changed. So what this result suggests, at least to me from the endocrine perspective, is that these mixtures are altering in some way with the way that the HPO axis is functioning. And so we might expect to see, with a change in LH and FSH, downstream effects on hormone-sensitive outcomes and hormone-sensitive organs. With a decrease in estradiol, we might expect to see effects on secondary sex organs. And that's where I come in. So when Susan contacted me and said that they had mammary glands from this experiment, and would I be interested in looking at them? The answer to a question like that is always yes. So a brief introduction to the mouse mammary gland and why it might be an appropriate model to probe chemical mixtures. The mouse has five pairs of mammary glands that are located along the ventral surface of the female. The great thing about this is that it means that you can get lots of samples for lots of different kinds of endpoints to evaluate, all from the same female. And so we could collect from single females mammary glands to be used for whole mount analysis. So you can look at the whole mammary gland and look at morphology, and I'll show you what that looks like in a second. We can also do histopathology, qPCR. We can look at things like the number of stem cells with flow cytometry. So there's lots of different options because there's lots of different pairs of these organs available to us. And again, just as a brief reminder, work from my lab and from labs of my collaborators and colleagues around the world have shown that the mammary gland is actually quite sensitive to the effects of hormones and hormonally active chemicals, EDCs. And we've seen some really fascinating effects where some of these chemicals can delay the development of the mammary gland and others can accelerate the development of the mammary gland. And some of that has to do with the different mechanism of action of these chemicals. There's also effects related to dose. And there's also important effects related to the timing of exposures. So this is what the mammary gland looks like prior to puberty. We like to think of it as a very small sapling or tree. And you can see the nipple down here is the trunk of that tree. And in just a few days, as the animal goes into puberty, you can see a massive expansion in the development of the mammary gland. And that expansion is largely driven by these structures that are referred to as terminal end buds, or TEBs. These are the large bulb-shaped structures here at the ends of each of the ducts, and they are comprised of highly proliferative epithelial cells that have the job of both chewing through the stromal matrix that's comprised mostly of fat and connective tissue, but also to proliferating and apoptosing at the same time, because you go from a structure that is solid here at the tip of the duct, but ultimately the purpose is to be able to create a hollow duct, a tube, through which eventually milk will be delivered. This period of rapid expansion occurs in the mouse over really about 10 days of puberty, so that by the time the animal reaches adulthood, when the TEBs reach the outer edges of that mammary fat pad, they regress, leaving behind a ductal tree that is beautiful in its simplicity, but really is comprised mostly of just ducts that have primary, secondary, and a very small number of tertiary branches. Just for orientation purposes, this is not a tumor. This is a central lymph node that serves as a marker so that we can keep track of how much the gland is growing. This is what the mammary gland looks like in early pregnancy. You can see both proliferation of those epithelial cells, as well as the beginning differentiation of those epithelial cells into alveolar buds, the structures that will eventually start to produce milk, because that's the purpose of the gland. And here's the lactating mammary gland with a close-up of the lobulo-alveolar units. And these are organized as bundles of cells that secrete milk into the ducts. You can see one duct here, and allow milk to be delivered back to the nipple when the pups are suckling. So again, we like to think about this as the metaphor of a tree over time, where the adult normally has a wintertime looking appearance, that at pregnancy and lactation, you have a summertime looking appearance. And then after weaning of the pups, you end up with something where the leaves start to fall off the tree during a process called involution. And a lot of these steps are dictated and controlled by hormones, which is why the mammary gland is such a fascinating organ to be able to study, and why exposure at different periods of time can produce very different effects on the morphology, on gene expression, on developmental parameters, as well as on function and disease of this gland. In working with Susan's group, they collected the mammary glands and sent them to our lab. What we found is that there was a modest decrease in the size of the mammary glands of females that were collected from those UOG mixed treated animals, but this decrease in the size of the mammary gland was not statistically significant. When we looked at these animals at early adulthood, we saw actually the opposite had occurred, where now these animals had significant increases in the number of epithelial structures that were present. And we often see this where at one period of life, we see what looks like a delay in the mammary gland, and then something that seems to be more than catching up, like an overshooting in response at another period of life. When we looked at things like what is the rate of epithelial cell proliferation versus apoptosis, we normally have a very low ratio in control animals because as adults, we normally see a pretty even number of cells in the mammary epithelium that are proliferating as the number of cells that are dying. What we saw was a shift in this proliferation to apoptosis rate in the animals exposed to the lowest dose of the UOG mixture. And this is really driven by about a fivefold increase in the number of cells that are proliferating in the epithelium. When we looked to see whether there were changes in the expression of hormone receptors, again, that mixture is a really complex mixture that's full of chemicals that are ER, AR, and PR antagonists. What we saw was no significant change in the fraction of cells that were expressing estrogen receptor, but there was an increase in the fraction of cells expressing androgen receptor, as well as the fraction of cells expressing progesterone receptor. What was really fascinating to us was we observed structures in the mammary epithelium at adulthood that we had never seen before in adult females. Again, when I showed you the developmental parameters, I showed you that normally these bulb-like structures that are found at the ends of ducts are present there only during puberty, during a period of rapid growth. So those are those highly proliferative structures of the mammary gland. What we saw were that these structures were retained in the animals that had been exposed to the UOG mixture. So we saw these bulb-like structures that look like TEBs, they look like terminal end buds, but they're present at a time long after we would expect them to be gone in adulthood. And just like Dr. Flaws saw, where we don't see these in controls, we had never seen these responses in controls, we are seeing them in the treated animals. And when we excised those TEB-like structures and evaluated them histopathologically, what we saw was that they were highly proliferative and they're also expressing estrogen receptor. This is just quantifying what I'm showing you here in this image. And a veterinary pathologist diagnosed these as intraductal hyperplasias. So these are pre-neoplastic lesions that are really on the pathway towards mammary cancer. And this is just a summary of the kinds of effects that we saw, which was modest increases in the amount of epithelium, but these striking structures that were retained at the tips of those mammary epithelium that are these risk factors for mammary cancer. So this is just our first prelude into using the mouse mammary gland as a model organism that can be used to evaluate mixtures. And we think that the mouse mammary gland could serve as a canary in the coal mine, a really sensitive organ for evaluating the effects of endocrine disruptor mixtures, including really complex mixtures like those that are used in unconventional oil and gas operations. Again, that mixture was based on what has been seen or measured out in fracking wastewater, but not meant to necessarily replicate the concentrations that are measured there, or even the relative proportions of what are measured there, because again, that changes from site to site, and is probably changing over time as well. What I think is also a really fascinating conclusion, and one to me is the biggest lesson from this, is the exciting opportunity that comes from doing collaborative science. And this work really, like I said, was the brainchild of Susan Nagel and Chris Kasotis. But what was the remarkable thing that they did is they isolated the tissues that they wanted to analyze, and they evaluated behavioral outcomes. Some of that work has continued to come out of Susan's lab from her continuing graduate students after Chris had completed his PhD. But they also collected tissues that they could share with collaborators. So tissues that they didn't feel comfortable analyzing, but they collected them and then shared them with me. That's the case with the mammary gland tissues with my lab, but also with a bunch of immune tissues that were shared with Paige Lawrence's lab. And what an amazing opportunity it is to take a really complex and quite expensive study and get some extra bang for your buck by sharing tissues with others. And I think that this is something, as we pursue mixture studies, that we should be attempting to do more and more, is to find collaborators who are willing to work within the constraints of the tissues we can provide to them, but to use them to continue evaluations. We also encountered a lot of challenges. What is the right mixture to use for an example like this? And when we think about consumer products and how complicated mixtures are in consumer products, we often see that, for example, a pesticide formulation that's used in the United States is very different from the same pesticide that has a different formulation used in Brazil or in Europe. I also think that it's important for us to think about how much do we need to know about the individual components in a mixture in order to study what would otherwise be a really interesting question about mixtures. And then one of the real challenges, what would be the best positive control to include in mixture studies? And with endocrine disrupting chemicals, we're often wanting to include really thoughtful positive controls. And it's much more complicated if you don't know which is the mechanism of action for the mixture as a whole that you might be studying. So there's a lot of work left to do, including studying long-term effects of these developmental exposures. We do have some of those samples from Susan's lab, and we're continuing to study them. And I'm also super interested in evaluating whether these mixtures might affect mammary gland function, as well as actually lead to disease outcomes. Let's not be afraid to study mixtures. That's the take-home message here. This kind of work is often difficult to get into. We're scared about whether we're doing the right mixture, but let's not be afraid. Let's brave the storms and start asking new questions. And I'm happy to answer any of the questions that you might have.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Vandenberg, for such a great presentation and beautiful slides. So there are, while people are thinking of their questions and putting them in the Q&A box, I also want to thank Dr. Flaws for answering the questions that we did not get to in the previous session. That's very helpful, so I appreciate that. All right, we have a question for Laura. It says, Laura, do you need to participate on study section because every time I propose to use mixtures, it's not received well. Is there any epi evidence about breast cancer and fracking?
One great comment and a great question. I actually feel very strongly that we often eat our young, and I mean that in the great sense of the word. I study maternal behavior, so I'm fascinated by chemicals that cause animals to eat their young. I have no evidence from fracking chemicals, but I think some of the more interesting questions, we are killing them on the vine because we're afraid that we need to have a really high threshold of information before we start doing mixture studies. And I think some of the talks that you've heard today suggest that there are different approaches to how we should think about what's the right kind of mixture. And so, you know, I think that what Dr. Flaws showed is a great way for us to think about mixtures. I think what we saw from Dr. Kortenkamp is a totally different way. Neither one of those is right or wrong. It's just different approaches. And I think that oftentimes we really get stuck into thinking that there is a right way to study mixtures when in fact this field is so new, there's no right way. There could be a wrong way, but I don't think we've seen it yet. So let's be more supportive at study section in thinking about how mixture studies can help contribute to the body of knowledge as a whole. I'm not aware of any studies that have linked fracking sites to increased risk of breast cancer. In fact, overall, the number of studies that have linked any environmental factors to breast cancer remain quite limited. And really, that's because of the nature of the disease in women, where we often are looking at measurements that are collected around the same time as when the disease manifests, when really what we need to do is to be looking maybe 5 decades earlier. That is not an easy task, right? So we're not talking about a disease with a short latency. And really some amazing work has come from Barbara Cohen's group and Mary Beth Terry and Michelle LaMerrill, who've all contributed to our knowledge about chemicals like DDT, which we only are just now appreciating. I mean, this is a chemical that we also study section judges and says, oh, we don't need to keep studying that. We're not exposed to that anymore. Not exactly true, but also we're only just now appreciating that a chemical like DDT really can contribute to breast cancer risk. So I think we've got a ways to go with the fracking chemicals to answer that question.
Great. I think we are out of time for questions, but there are a few more. We can either...
I will answer them in the chat.
That's excellent. Totally thank you. Yes. We can also think about them if in the panel as well, if it comes up at that point. So thank you very much. I think we are now I'm going to hand it off to Rebecca to introduce our next speaker.
Yes, thank you. I am going to be introducing Professor Paul Fowler. And Professor Fowler is a chair in translational medical sciences and the director of the Institute of Medical Science at the University of Aberdeen. His career is focused on elucidating the mechanisms that regulate reproduction, including the effects of environmental exposures and endocrine disruption on fetal development and health in human and animal models. And Professor Fowler's talk today is entitled Exposure to the Complex Mixture of Environmental Chemicals Found in Human Biosolids. Professor Fowler, if you're ready to come on screen and unmute yourself and share your slides, we're ready to have you.
Thank you very much. Is the presentation showing?
That looks wonderful.
Okay, great. So thank you for inviting me. And it's been very interesting listening to the previous speakers, some of whom have made points I was going to make. So if I make them, it's purely to emphasize the importance of what they said. So I have no conflicts to declare, just to state that I am sitting on the food additives and flavoring panel of the European Food Safety Authority. So this is where the talk goes a bit downhill, as it were, and we're going to talk about essentially, as one colleague said to me, Paul, you really do talk a pile of shit sometimes. And this is what we have here. Biosolids, residuals, and sludge, these are all what you get when you process wastewater. And the old-fashioned term for this is night soil, and human feces and urine have long been used in agriculture. Sewage sludge and biosolids are where wastewater is recovered and the solids are processed to a greater or lesser extent and then can be used for other things. So that's what it is. And if you think about it, that's a lovely little capsule of the environment, all in one, I would say, tidy package. How much of this stuff is there? Well, that's very difficult to estimate globally, but one estimate is that some 300 cubic kilometers per year of municipal wastewater is generated around the world, processed properly, and made safe, it could irrigate and fertilize millions of hectares of crops. And if you take out the methane, you can use biogas to supply energy. The sobering thought around the world is only a tiny proportion of wastes are currently treated. And so if you try and find the epidemiology of this field, a lot of it focuses on parasites, heavy metals, and so on in third world countries with a very poor sanitation. Very hard to find anything in terms of epidemiology for the developed nations. So what use is processed sewage? what can you do with it? Well, there are a lot of things. Land remediation, so brownfield sites. Brownfield sites are sites which were once industrial or held toxic processes. It can be used as a biofuel. You can burn dried blocks or get the methane out. It's very widely used as a fertilizer. Suggestions of using it for carbon sequestration, and I can't really comment on that. And some recent developments actually using it as components in bricks. So one point I'd like to make to you is if we switch around our view of the world is like the materno-fetal unit. So the world is like the amniotic fluid, the placenta and the mother, and we're the fetus. What we produce and consume and excrete comes back. So this is just like the fetus in the mother drinking amniotic fluid and then urinating into it and then drinking it again. So what goes around comes around. And that's sobering when you think about what ends up in biosolids. So human and animal waste, there are nutrients, there are pollutants, all sorts of things in terms of pollutants, industrial effluent, industrial waste, rainfall enters into this process. And of course that brings precipitated air pollution items, agricultural runoff, domestic waste, which would include things like personal care products and so on. Oceanic pollution that's carried up into the sky, into the rain, and then back onto the land. Of course, some of these compounds are endocrine disruptors, and there are also pharmaceuticals, pesticides, herbicides, antibiotics. And then we come to things like parasites, microorganisms, and the toxins produced by microorganisms. And a new product to worry us is microplastics, and of course, an old product in this is heavy metals. A key here really for our safety and sanity is that there have been big strides in processing of sewage and wastewater to remove contaminants. And this is a very active field. If you do a literature search, you'll find plenty of new approaches. And just to really emphasize that it is important to think that there are a lot of bioactive compounds, such as medicines, which are designed to be long acting and to survive a long time, present in wastewater and entering biosolids. So I came into this field because of endocrine disruption. I won't define it, you've just had that before. And it was Stuart Ryan back in 2006 who worked at the James Hutton Institute in Aberdeen, who talked me over several pints into joining him on the study to look at the effects of sewage sludge used as a fertilizer on sheep. His model was Texel sheep, and he used Scottish hill farms. So these are farms on in harsh climates on the Scottish hills. So there is no problem with plants such as red clover, which is estrogenic and can affect sheep pregnancy. The processed sewage sludge is applied according to agricultural guidelines. And in the case in the UK, this is dried pellets injected into the soil. There is nitrogen supplementation if necessary. And as a control, we used inorganic fertilizer. Obviously, this is done outside in fields, so they're exposed to environmental pollution as well. So it really is a real life model. And the reasons we're interested in this kind of thing can be summarized here by some epidemiological data. This is in humans, looking at different classes of compounds, some of which are endocrine disruptors, and they're having an effect on pregnancy outcomes. Some are estrogenic, some affect thyroid systems, some cause congenital malformations, and some change epigenetic signatures in tissues such as the placenta. So it's this kind of epidemiological information that was driving our interest, as well as the health and safety and environmental health issues. And of course, what you're exposed to in the womb does shape your life to come. So what's in this biosolid? So this is quite complicated, but it's only a few compounds. And we have things like phthalate, PCBs, and polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And you can see that compared to the inorganic fertilizer, there's a lot more of these endocrine disrupting compounds than in inorganic fertilizer. That's all very well, though, isn't it? That is the biosolid itself, and that really doesn't tell us much about what the risks might be, the magnitude of the risk. So when you apply the biosolids to soil and then measure what gets into the soil, you can see there's a fivefold to order of magnitude drop in the amount of biosolid. So if I just flip back, milligrams per kilogram dry matter, and here we've got nanograms per kilogram dry matter or micrograms per kilogram dry matter. But what you can nevertheless see is that in control pastures, so inorganic fertilizer, for most of the compounds, you still have far less than you would see in the treated fields. So there is still an impact in terms of depositing relatively serious quantities of endocrine disrupting compounds into the soil. Okay, but we're still not in the animal and definitely still not in the human. And I should say not in the animal or the plant. So what happens if you then drill down further? I should say here are some data on bisphenol A, which is a chemical of considerable interest and controversy, depending which part of the wide spectrum of views you sit on. But here is soil concentrations of BPA varying with time. And you can see in this color here is control, and in the blue is treated, so sewage sludge treated field. And you can see the variation. So we have treatment here and then climbs and declines. What I would like to point out though, is if you have short-term exposure, in this case, we're getting around 4 nanograms per gram of bisphenol A in the soil, but treating twice a year for 13 years, which is by no means exceptional treatment using biosolid fertilizer, we were getting 63 nanograms per gram. And if we looked at the potential human hazard, and this was calculated by Zulin Zhang at Stewart's Institute, you can see that in the short-term exposure, you've got relatively low possible human exposure to bisphenol A. But here you can see for these two plots with long-term exposure, then you're starting to get up to still a pretty small exposure, but it's starting to become more noticeable in terms of being a component of what the overall exposure to bisphenol A would be. Okay, so it is getting into the cereals, into leaves and roots, and into the soil. And that leads me on to the sewage sludge studies themselves. And over the years, we had these three main categories of study: always treated, never treated, usually killing the fetuses at around day 110 of 145-day pregnancy, or letting them live to 18 months. Then we had the crossover study, which is where we wanted to see if the mother was used to being on sewage sludge and went to inorganic, or was used to being on inorganic and then went to sewage sludge, did we see a different kind of effect? Finally, we wanted to look at windows of exposure. So we have the always and the never groups, but here we have a group exposed early, then mid, and then late gestation. And this is to try and work out when we were seeing the worst effects. So I can't talk about all these studies in detail, so I want to scamper through just two of them. One is the windows study. And you can see here the always exposed, and these three columns are the windows. You don't have to look at the information in detail, just look at the bold figures. So here is where fetal weight is affected in all the windows, but not always. Here you can see anogenital distance is exposed and affected in two groups, and this is a masculinization effect. The anogenital distance goes up. The late exposed group has thyroid changes. You can see changes in thyroid hormones as well as thyroid weight. It looks like the thyroid gland is trying to overcompensate, but isn't achieving that in terms of T3. changes in liver. What should strike you, and the key point, is how variable the outcomes are. Look how few of them show statistical significance. And if we drill further into these female offspring, here's the ovary counts, and you can see that all the treatment groups show a decrease in number of activated primordial follicles, but the most affected is the mid-exposure group. And the three windows all show an increase in the proportion of these activated follicles that are becoming atretic. So here you can see very clear atretic follicles. Here is a very clear activated follicle. Here's a primordial resting follicle. So there's an effect here. It's significant, but it's not a big effect in terms of the numbers. Remember that this axis is clipped to show both things. So it's only about a 10 to 15% decrease. But when we looked at the transcriptomics of these fetuses, it was quite shocking. So you can see some decrease, some increased in the always exposed, but it's these two later windows that show a large number of decreased genes, quite astonishingly. And we believe the mechanism behind this is that we found that 14 genes involved in histone methylation and MTHFD1 protein in these ovaries were altered in the 30 to 110 and 60 to 140 groups. And the effect of this would be to disturb gene methylation and affect gene expression in these groups. So taken together with this fundamental shift in, if you like, the health of these follicles in terms of a likely reduction in gene expression, together with a small change in follicle numbers, taken to the human, would suggest some increase in risk of infertility. What kind of exposures were these animals getting, though, really? Again, this is complicated, but all you need to look at is this lot is mothers, this lot is fetuses, the blue bar is control, the rest is exposed. And the take-home message in any of these, if you look at them, is here's this PAH increases in the late exposed mother livers. In the fetus, there is no change. Here, this PCB goes up, particularly in the mid-exposed group in the fetal liver. In the maternal liver, there is no change. And this is typical of all the sewage sludge studies. Enormously variable levels of these compounds in both the maternal and fetal tissues, and very little overall increase in terms of quantities of these compounds. So the complex mixtures present are causing morphological effects, but with highly variable changes in concentration. And here we have a male study, and what we're looking at is whether the effects persist into adulthood. So in fetal life, you see real changes and adverse changes in testis development. If we then let the animals grow into adulthood, here you can see if we look at testis weight, most of them show no change, and we have three that show small testes. If we then look at endocrinology, we pick out five animals that are different from the other eight in the control group. And what these animals have is reduced germ cell numbers. And also, if you look here, this is germ cells per Sertoli cell. So each Sertoli cell in these five animals, but not these eight, cannot support as many germ cells, which has huge implications for fertility. This data is much more like human data than rodent data. And this shows really that we are seeing with this model some quite significant changes. And even more stunningly, if I use a visual message for you, here is a normal seminiferous tubule in the testis. You can see the Sertoli cells here on the edge. And look at all these germ cells. Here are the sperm. Here are all these growing germ cells. In the exposed animals, these five, look at this. This is a seminiferous tubule, which only has Sertoli cells. Enough of those and the individual will be infertile. So looking at the time, I am going to move on to the summary figure for these experiments. And it will take me a little time to go through it. So this is a summary of a whole load of experiments done. The animals receive chemicals in sewage sludge. They eat the grass, of course, which is growing on the soil. They're exposed to environmental chemicals as well. We know that endocrine disruptors and other compounds accumulate in the soil over time, and that the levels are highly variable, but higher than controlled pastures. And we've looked at a huge range of outcomes, and this has been a big collaborative effort. When we did the slaughters of the mothers, in particular, to collect tissues, we had up to seven different research groups congregating outside Aberdeen, and a very efficient mechanism to pass the tissues around for very rapid processing for freezing or for histology. And I want to just take you through some categories. So in reproduction, particularly in the females, we see changes in follicle population, apoptosis, changes in the proteome, the transcriptome, endocrine changes. We think the mid-gestation window, the mid to late gestation windows, are the most sensitive in the female, which is different from the male. And we've also found that just moving the mother from sewage sludge to control also causes changes in the fetus. So there are not just your level of exposure, but whether your exposures change markedly during pregnancy may affect the fetus. Do adverse effects persist into adulthood in the ovary? Some do, some don't. What I can say is that particularly in the late exposed females, we see this small uterine size and increased anogenital distance, which is indicative of virilization. In males, in the fetus, we see changes and adverse changes in all cell types in the testis, other than the peritubular myoid cells. We see changes in endocrinology, and these adverse effects persist into adulthood. If we look at bone, then bone density and bone morphometrics are adversely affected. And if we look in the adult, these are sex-specific. I forget which way round, but only one of the sexes maintains this bone density change into adulthood. If we look at the thyroid, we see defects in angiogenesis in the thyroid and defects in follicle number and differentiation. And again, there are sex-specific differences here. And again, as with the ovary, we see effects of whether the exposure to the mother occurs pre or post conception and whether she's switched from one environment to another. In terms of the liver, we see changes in detoxification, liver and blood proteins alter, lipid dynamics alters, multiple omics effects. In females, we see lower total lipid levels with fetal exposure. And this goes into adulthood. I'm sorry, my mouse is misbehaving. This goes into adulthood. In males, we see upregulated cancer pathway. Males show changed behavioral behavior and female pattern exploratory behavior. And when we look at the central nervous system, we see changes in the hypothalamus and pituitary. The kisspeptin system is altered, suggesting increased likelihood of pubertal abnormalities, changes in the GnRH system and estrogen receptor system, reduction in sexual dimorphism, and again, depending on pre and post conception exposure, we see different effects. So to wrap that up, we see disrupted fetal development, some of it lasting into adult function, based on exposure to very complex mixtures that accumulate in the soil. And the timing of this exposure looks like it's very important, although changes in exposure clearly have an effect on outcome. So I want to do a very brief SWOT analysis. So what are the strengths of the model? Well, it's a genuine real-life exposure. It involves complex mixtures, there. It involves accumulation of compounds, and our data is used an animal model, the sheep, that shows the same developmental scheduling as the human, which is rather different than the rodent. The weaknesses are, and these can't be ignored, that the exposures between experiments are very variable, but that is also a strength. We see very variable exposure, but some similarities in outcomes. If I speak to a risk assessor, there's a real problem here with this complex mixture. The risk assessor wishes to know which of these compounds is the smoking gun or smoking guns. We don't have a clue. There's considerable further work needed to try and unravel that. And you've already heard several speakers allude to these problems, so I won't repeat those. Another potential weakness, although it's also a strength, is of course that the animals are exposed to environmental pollutants. And I'll finish just with two questions. Will sewage sludge chemicals get into the food chain? Yes, they will. They'll get through in meat of exposed animals and also in things like cereals from sewage sludge fertilized fields. Should we be worried about biosolids in terms of risk to health and function? I think yes, we should be worried. There is a light at the end of the tunnel though, and that's the pressure on water companies and water recycling companies to improve cleanup. And there's a huge amount of research going into that. So thank you for your attention, everyone.
Thank you so much. That was a really interesting presentation, and I love the one-liners you were able to slip in there to boot. So I think the last question that you had there about the risks that we should worry about for broader health implications goes kind of in with our first question, which is, given the risk that you see in your research, is promoting organic foods foods wise, or is there another way that we would kind of go about it?
Well, I think that depends whether we have the luxury to promote the organic foods. But one of the things that's an ironic problem is that Stuart was contacted, for instance, by a beef producer in England who had an organic beef farm, and guess what they used to fertilize the pastures? Sewage sludge. But they were not applying any pesticides or weed killers or anything. So it's a very difficult one. What's the individual risk to us as humans? That's really hard to measure. We had a whole program of work outlined, and unfortunately in 2013, Stuart was killed in a car crash. The James Hutton Institute had no reason then to maintain what was a very expensive model. And that line of inquiry came to an end for us. The model has been established in Glasgow. And I know Vasantha Padmanahan here at your institute is also extremely interested in that model. As with all these complex mixtures, it's really difficult. But we can't just ignore it and sweep it down the sewer, as it were.
All right, Rebecca, you're muted. Or she's frozen. I can't.
Oh, dear. These things happen.
All right. Right. So I will go ahead and ask a question from the attendees. This question is, I'm looking at PFAS uptake in plants, and I'm having trouble finding a lab that can measure PFAS in soil or in plant material. Do you have any suggestions?
Zulin Zhang at the James Hutton Institute, and at least one of his papers was linked in my talk. Was the chemist, the biochemist who did this work, a lot of this analytical work. He could answer that question. But there are many labs around the world who do measure PFAS, but yes, I understand there are some problems with that.
Okay, one more. Does sludge treatment affect the microbiome of the sheep?
That's a very good question. We would predict probably. That's not something we looked at, unfortunately. We had contacted a couple of microbiome people to go forward with that until Stuart's early demise.
One more. Okay. Thank you for your interesting talk, Dr. Fowler. There are some operations that compost biosolids. Do you know how this affects environmental chemical composition and availability?
Oh, there's a huge amount of different methods that can be used for processing wastewater and producing the biosolids. And some of them appear to be more effective than others, reading the literature, but it's going beyond my field of expertise. I'm just relieved to see the amount of research that is going on, because when Stuart first dragged me to a bar and started talking about sewage sludge, I was not minded to put my toe in the proverbial.
Yes.
But then we did the first count, and the student came through with these greatly reduced numbers of follicles, so I sent her away to do it again and mixed the slides up, and she got the same result. And after that, I was hooked that this is a genuine effect. What bothers me is finding the cause or causes and the effect. And this is true of all these complex mixture effects. And I have it for my other research, part of which is looking at maternal smoking and the effect on the first and second trimester human fetus, or indeed of maternal drug use.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, Professor Fowler. It's for your great talk. I think we should move to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Jyotsna Jagai. If you want to share your slides. All right. So Dr. Jagai is a research assistant professor in the Division of Environmental and Occupational Health Sciences at the University of Illinois at Chicago. Her talk is titled Cumulative Environmental Quality and Diabetes Rates and Control. Dr. Jagai is an environmental epidemiologist whose work focuses primarily on the impact of cumulative environmental exposures on health outcomes and health disparities. She has worked on the development of comprehensive indicators to characterize the cumulative environmental impact on human health, particularly chronic disease outcomes such as diabetes and cancer. And I think it's all yours. Thank you.
Thank you so much. First, I want to thank you all that the M-LEEaD Institute or Center for inviting me to participate on this panel. It's been a great set of presentations. And of course, I'm a little anxious to be the last one to go after all of these great presentations. So just to get started, I want to talk to you all a little bit about diabetes. As we know, it's a chronic condition that has the potential to have significant long-term health impacts. It can result in impacts that we see here, including blindness, kidney failure, amputations, and cardiovascular disease. The issue with that is that it has a tremendous economic toll on, and in the US, it's been estimated that that toll can reach up to $327 billion annually, and it continues to climb, as this was the estimate from 2017. And not only are the rates of diabetes increasing in the US, they are continuing to increase worldwide. This figure here is from the International Diabetes Federation, and it shows the number of adults with diabetes worldwide, and then the estimates for the coming years of 2030 and 2045. And as you can see, by 2045, they're estimating 700 million people with diabetes worldwide. And this is something that is a global issue. The rates throughout the world are continuing to increase, as these percentages are shown here. And it's not only in North America, but also in Middle East and Northern Africa and the Western Pacific, which demonstrates some of the highest rates throughout. So we know that the primary drivers of diabetes are diet and exercise and some genetic factors. However, what we have seen is that these factors alone fail to fully account for the magnitude and rapidity with which diabetes rates have increased around the globe. So one of the things we've been thinking a lot about is whether environmental pollutants may be one of an added potential contributor to these increasing rates. So this is a very simple correlation figure, but the red line here is showing the synthetic chemical production in the United States. And so you can see as chemical production has increased, the diabetes rates have also increased in a similar fashion. Again, we're not saying that this is all due to chemicals in any way, but it's just a correlation that could be of interest. And might lead us to think about environmental pollutants as one of the drivers of diabetes prevalence. And what's unfortunate about that is that it really is a disproportionate impact in the US in particular, where if diabetes is associated with environmental conditions or environmental exposures, it can also be one of the explanations for the marked differences that we see in rates of diabetes among populations of color. So in the US, we see higher rates of diabetes in the Black non-Hispanic population, as well as the Mexican American population. And a review paper that we worked on together with several others demonstrated that really some of the endocrine disrupting chemicals have higher exposures in these populations of color. So one of the important things for us to recognize is that we're not exposed to any one particular toxicant or endocrine disrupting pollutant at a time, but rather that these environmental and environmental exposures occur simultaneously. And often, as is the case, the pollutants and concerns that can impact health poorly go together, and things that might benefit our health, such as parks, recreation, clean air, tend to go together in communities. And so one of the challenges is really understanding the environmental drivers of risk and being able to take into account the simultaneous impacts of these various factors. So we are approaching this mixtures question in a very different fashion than the previous presenters have. And the goal in this with this project was to develop an environmental quality index. And that index is for all counties in the US, taking into account multiple domains that influence exposure and health. So we considered five different domains: air, water, land, the built environment, and the socio-demographic environment. And then within each of those domains, we wanted to make sure to incorporate data that represented the chemical, natural, and built environments. So the index is set for the period of 2000 to 2005, and we looked at data from 19 different sources, again, looking at these five environmental domains. We created domain-specific indices, and I'll go into some detail about this, for all counties in the US using a principal component analysis. And then we combined those domain-specific indices, again, using another principal component analysis to create the overall index. So just to give you a flavor of what types of data sets and variables we used in each of these domains, these are a list of some of the example variables that were created. So in the air domain, we used data from the Environmental Protection Agency on criteria and hazardous air pollutants, particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, chlorine, and lead compounds. Again, this is just a subset of some of the variables considered. In the water domain, we used a contaminant database. We also used some proxy measures that might allow us to understand some of the drivers of environment of water quality. So for example, we looked at drought status, the number of discharge permits in a county, water withdrawals for various uses, including domestic and industrial. In the land domain, again, we had a couple of variables that might act as proxies. So the percentage of land in wheat crops is potentially a proxy for pesticide use on wheat, insecticide treated crops, the count of Superfund sites and brownfields, and then arsenic concentrations from sediment samples as, again, examples that of data that sets and variables that we put into the land domain. The socio-demographic domain was primarily made out of variables and data from the U.S. Census that included median household income, percent of individuals with less than a high school education. We also were able to get some data from on violent crimes and property crimes that we used in the socio-demographic domain. And then the built domain, we used data on industries and types of industries that were in each county. So we were able to develop an index for, or a variable for the density of fast food restaurants, for example. We were also able to get data on roadways and highways and accidents, as well as public housing units. So in addition to fast food restaurants from this data set that included industries in an area, we were able to construct variables on access and the number of clinics and beds, hospital access, and parks, and sorry, not parks, but recreational facilities, also in that from that same data set. So one of the things that we realized very early on in this project was the fact that the drivers of environmental quality in the US vary greatly in areas that are urban and areas that are suburban and more rural. And so we used this continuum code from the US Department of Agriculture, I believe, and classified all of the counties in the US using this four-tiered structure from metropolitan urbanized to thinly populated counties. So given all that I've just said, now is an try to conceptually see how the EQI was actually developed. So from all those variables I mentioned in the in each of the domains, we had those individual variables. And then we used the urban-rural stratification to create individual domain indices, as well as an overall domain index for each of the domains, and then using a principal component analysis. And then again, for each of the strata, as well as overall, we used another principal component analysis to create the final environmental quality index. So for those of you who tend to be a little bit more quantitative and wanted to see this in an equation format, we used a principal components analysis. And here you can see that the EQI was a sum of all of the domain indices for each of the counties and for each of the variables taken into account in each county. So after all of that, this was the map we were able to develop for the time period 2000 to 2005. And so the purple areas are the most urban, metropolitan urbanized areas, and the green are the thinly populated counties. And as the shades get darker, the environmental quality decreases. So the higher values represent poor environmental quality. So you can see this tracks fairly well to urbanization and cities. Excuse me. And so you can see that counties that are densely populated and in urban areas have the poorest environmental quality. So then we wanted to, one second. I'm sorry about that. So then we wanted to relate the environmental quality index and use it as an exposure variable to look at associations with diabetes prevalence. So we use data from this paper here by colleagues, Dr. Dwyer Lundgren and her colleagues, where they estimated diagnosed and undiagnosed diabetes prevalence in all the counties in the US. They used the National Health and Nutrition Environment Examination Survey, as well as the Behavioral Risk Factors Surveillance System data in order to create these estimates. And the estimates they developed were for 1999 to 2012. So then we conducted a statistical analysis using a random intercept multi-level linear regression model clustered by state to estimate the prevalence differences and 95% confidence intervals. We looked at the overall environmental quality index as well as the five domain-specific indices. And given that we were looking at county-level data, we adjusted for county-level obesity rates as well as leisure time physical inactivity. And lastly, as I mentioned, the analyses were stratified by rural and urban continuum. So now I'll walk you through some of the results. So when we considered all counties, we found that as environmental quality decreased, prevalence of diabetes decreased, which was not what we would expect. However, we did see very strong positive associations for all counties with the socio-demographic environment, and some positive but not as strong associations with the built environment. But what we did notice was that the results were very different as we started to look at the urban and rural strata. So in our most urban areas, you can see that in the overall environmental quality was not really associated with diabetes prevalence rates. However, as environmental quality or air quality decreased, diabetes rates did increase in our most urban areas. Again, we saw very strong associations with the socio-demographic environment as well, and not really anything with the water, land, or built environments. For our UCC2, again, which is kind of our suburban counties, we only really saw an association with environmental quality in the socio-demographic domain. So as the socio-demographic domain quality decreased, the rates of diabetes prevalence increased. But it was when we started moving into the more rural counties in what's called the less urbanized counties, we really started to see changes, where as environmental quality decreased, we saw a very marked increase in diabetes prevalence. Again, very strong associations with the socio-demographic domain as well as defined associations with the built domain. And again, these were extremely strong when we started to consider the thinly populated counties with overall environmental quality as well as with the socio-demographic domain. So I know that was a lot of results, but hopefully this table will help us be able to kind of pull everything together. So with poor overall environmental quality, we saw associated with rates of total diabetes prevalence, decreased rates of total diabetes prevalence. However, increased rates of diabetes prevalence for the less urbanized and thinly populated areas. Again, no association with the air quality domain, except for in RUCC1, and the opposite in our thinly populated and rural counties. no associations with water and land. Sociodemographic domain, we saw positive associations in both, and with the built only in certain counties, not in the urban counties. So then, given the strong relationships we saw with the built and sociodemographic counties, we wanted to look at diabetes control, because control is an important indicator for the development of diabetes complications. And the impact of, and no one has really thought about what the potential impact of environmental exposures might be on control. Control is defined as a proportion of people who had previously been diagnosed with diabetes, but do not currently have high fasting plasma. So those are people who have their condition in some type of controlled status. Again, we were able to use estimates from the same group that estimated the prevalence data for all counties. And they also estimated the control data for all counties. Again, we conducted the same analysis and again controlled for county level obesity and leisure time inactivity. In this case, it's a little bit tricky because we have to think about the outcome differently, because control is a positive outcome as opposed to diabetes prevalence, which is a negative outcome. So in this case, we did see associations we would expect. So as environmental control decreased, diabetes control decreased. And then this is for all counties in the US. We did not see associations with the air domain, minimal associations with the water, land, but then very strong associations again with the sociodemographic and built domain, that as domain quality decreased, the rates of diabetes control decreased. And again, we started to see very different relationships based on the urban-rural strata. So in this case, in our most urban counties, as overall environmental quality decreased, the rates of diabetes control decreased. And again, the strongest associations were seen in the sociodemographic and built environment, even though we did see some marginal associations in the land domain. And when we considered the non-metropolitan urbanized counties, again, we saw associations with overall environmental quality, a little bit with the land, sociodemographic as well. And again, the same was true, the associations and relationships, when we considered the less urbanized counties and the thinly populated counties. We started to see a little bit less of a distinct relationship with the overall environmental quality, but still saw strong relationships with the sociodemographic domain. So again, this is just a summary table showing that as environmental quality decreased, rates of diabetes control decreased for all counties, as well as by all count strata. For air quality, we saw that was true for all counties. Same with water, land, sociodemographic, and built. So with diabetes control, we started to see a lot more of the expected associations than we did with diabetes prevalence. So some conclusions from this work is really that poor environmental quality is not associated with diabetes outcomes, but rather that this is a really complex relationship that is not captured by the overall environmental quality index. As you could see in the two analyses I presented here, we saw expected associations with diabetes control, but not necessarily with diabetes prevalence. And the strongest associations with control were seen in the built and sociodemographic environments, as well as with prevalence, we saw very strong associations with the sociodemographic domain. Counties are heterogeneous and likely too diffuse of an exposure metric. because one of the things we are looking at in both of these analyses is county level rates of diabetes, either prevalence or control, as opposed to individual level data, which would be a natural next step, and allowing us to kind of tease apart some of the behavioral pieces from the environmental exposures. And one of the other things is that given that we have a very diffuse exposure metric of a county, we really need to start considering a smaller geographic resolution to see if we might be able to look at these associations in more detail. So some of the limitations of this work are really that as far as constructing the EQI, one of the biggest challenges is the spatial coverage of constituent variables. Many of the variables that we considered are monitored variables or data that are collected at monitoring sites. And so that required kriging or other spatial interpolation methods in order to get coverage for all counties in the US. Temporal coverage of these constituent variables, the majority of the data sets we utilized in this analysis or in the development of the EQI were data sets that are collected for regulatory purposes. And so, as I mentioned, the EQI is for the time period 2000 to 2005, because we were originally and ideally hoping to be able to construct an EQI for every year. However, the data for most of the variables was just not available at that temporal resolution. And so in order to incorporate as many variables as we could, we had to utilize a longer time period. There is a potential for urban bias in this type of work because, again, a lot of our regulatory processes in the US in particular are based on health impacts for certain population or the majority of the population. And so they are looking at data monitoring sites, for example, for air pollution monitors are primarily in urban areas. So as far as the analysis with the diabetes outcomes, we were unable to look at racial differences due to low counts, but then also due to the fact that we were looking at county level data. And we aren't able to account for the movement of people over time, which is something that might impact or would impact their environmental exposures. So some of the strengths that this is really the first attempt to model the multifactorial nature of ambient environmental exposures in this way, thinking about so many different domains of exposure. And we were also able to really tease or separate some of the differences between urban and rural areas in the construction of the EQI. The analysis with diabetes is a national scale analysis, which is really allows us to think about larger context issues and really think about the broader environmental context and the impacts on diabetes and other health impacts. So one of the things we've been thinking about is whether we can consider more specific endocrine disrupting chemicals within the EQI data as opposed to using all of the variables in the EQI. And as I mentioned earlier, we are currently in the process of working on constructing an index at the census tract level, which should be available probably within the next year. And so that would allow us to look at data at a much finer scale and potentially allow us to utilize individual level data with a exposure that is a little bit more geographically resolved. The other thing, today I've just presented some of the results with our diabetes outcomes, but this EQI data or index has been utilized looking at various other outcomes ranging from preterm birth to cancer. So if that's something of interest and the relationships have varied across all different health outcomes. So if that's of interest, I can direct you to some of those papers as well.
So for this diabetes work, I really want to thank some collaborators, including Dr. Rob Sarges, who's at the University of Illinois at Chicago as well, Sabina Schock, who's at the University of Chicago, and Allison Kryaski, who is with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and all of my collaborators that pulled together the index, which is work that I started doing as a postdoc at the U.S. EPA, and some different funding sources for this work as well. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you so much. At the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned that this was very different from the other talks. And I really appreciate that because it's getting a bigger picture of the mixtures thing. So thank you. I think we have time for one question. And you somewhat addressed it in your limitations, but this is in regard to analysis at a finer scale. This comment is, it would be useful to think of occupational exposures in that a major thrust and change since 2005 is to try to get finely grained or spatially resolved data regarding environmental exposures and to even account for housing and work differences. This might apply to many of your exposure metrics, and the ecological fallacy might explain the lack of association with air, water, and perhaps land. So I think the biggest question there is about how, you know, incorporating the occupational aspect into the EQI.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, one of the advantages of the EQI is that it's environmental ambient data. And so then whatever individual level data you can utilize would, you know, only complement. So for example, if you have individual level data, I'm thinking about like the work we did on preterm birth. They had individual level birth outcomes and were able to control for a lot of the maternal factors, you know, maternal age, smoking status, all of the things that one might expect. And so I think if we had health outcome data at the individual level, it would allow us to control for things like occupational exposures, which really wouldn't be appropriate to incorporate in something like the EQI because it is just a much broader scope. The purpose of it is very different. So that is a great point because I do think that individual level data on the health outcome piece is where would allow us to really look at, allow us to adjust for some of these other factors that would be natural to think about.
Right. All right. I think we are out of time for questions, but thank you again. And now I think it's time to switch over to our panel, and Rebecca is going to be hosting that portion. So it's all yours, Rebecca.
Thank you. So we have a really awesome part of the presentations now. We had all this information that we talked about and so many great, technical presentations. And we have three wonderful scientists here today who have very different specialties within this realm. We're going to talk about their perspectives. I invite you all, if you think of any other questions, to submit them again during the Q&A during this part of the session. But for now, I'm going to introduce our three panelists. First up, we have Dr. Jennifer McPartland, who is a senior scientist at the Health Program of the Environmental Defense Fund. And Dr. McPartland is focusing on advancing policy, market, and science solutions to protect human health and the environment from harmful chemical exposures. We also have Dr. Natalie Sampson, who is an associate professor of environmental health at the University of Michigan, Dearborn. And Dr. Sampson teaches courses in environmental health, community organizing, and health promotion. And in Southeast Michigan, she studies transportation and land use planning, stormwater infrastructure, vacant land reuse, and climate change planning efforts, and how all of these relate to health. And then finally, we have Dr. Zorimar Rivera-Núñez, who is an assistant research professor of biostatistics and epidemiology at Rutgers. And Dr. Rivera-Núñez studies in early life chemical exposures, subsequent health effects, including birth outcomes and children development. And her work is mostly focused on the effect of measurement error in characterizing environmental exposure and the utility of biomarkers, identifying window of exposure and susceptibility. So we have three really diverse scientists who I'm going to invite just one by one, first talking about their perspectives and how we might be able to use some of the information that we learned today in our mixture symposium here, how we're going to take this forward into the future in the world of policy, education, and analytics. So Dr. McPartland, we'll start with you perhaps.
Yeah, great. And thank you for having me. This has been a really impressive lineup of presentations, and it was nice to see some familiar faces that I haven't seen in quite some time. So I thought I would sort of keep my remarks primarily to the work that I do in the policy arena. And it will be primarily US-centric since that's where my expertise really falls. I mean, I think throughout today we have heard ample evidence and we sort of intuitive that we are exposed to multiple substances all the time and that it varies also over time. And I don't know that anybody explicitly used the term of windows of susceptibility, although yes, I do. I do think people use that term. But not only is there variability of the substances to which we are exposed across time, but when those exposures occur are pretty critical in terms of assessing and understanding what the health impact of that may be. The other thing that we know, and Dr. Jagai got to this in her presentation, is that not only are we exposed to chemical mixtures, we're also exposed to other co-stressors, which can modify and influence, the impact of any individual chemical substance exposure as well as mixture exposures. Historically, like our regulatory frameworks in the United States have been very much a sort of chemical by chemical paradigm in which there will be a particular substance of interest, and then the idea is that you would assess the potential hazards associated with that substance and then examine how much people are exposed to that substance. And then if you are able to successfully do all of that, then you might think about what risk management practices may be applied to mitigate any unreasonable risk. The work that I do is primarily focused on the Toxic Substances Control Act, or TSCA, which some of you may be familiar with, different statutes at the federal level that also address chemicals have different provisions and different considerations around mixtures. But I think it's probably fair to say that by and large, historically, even across these varied statutes and regulations, it really is chemical by chemical. And that being said, some of that we could tie back to the way that these laws have been constructed. But in other instances, there actually are pathways in existing laws and regulations to get at mixtures. There's just been almost a scientific or cultural resistance to doing it. And I think part of it may be inertia or a sort of human inclination to be sort of adverse to change. And in other instances, there may be a willingness, but it may be feels at some at points scientifically too challenging to actually implement and address. And so what we've seen in the Toxic Substances Control Act, or TSCA, there are specific provisions that require the agency EPA to evaluate potentially exposed and susceptible subpopulations. That's a term of art in the law. And potentially exposed, meaning those individuals or communities that may be populations that may be disproportionately exposed, but susceptible populations, meaning those individuals or subpopulations that are, for any variety of reasons, potentially more susceptible to a particular chemical exposure. And we at EDF feel that especially this requirement to protect susceptible subpopulations provides a really a real opportunity to address mixtures and to address cumulative risks. And so that even though the law itself kind of enter into law through a specific individual chemical, once you're into the evaluation, the risk to a population or to an individual to that exposure will be influenced heavily by other factors, other co-exposures. So that's how we get at mixtures, underlying health conditions, variants in genetics, for example. And we have repeatedly raise this with the agency. And I would say that all the risk evaluations that have been completed to date have all occurred under the previous administration. So the next set of risk evaluations will be completed within this administration. So it'll be interesting to see the difference. Even in the previous administration, what we saw actually occur is that an acknowledgement that there are susceptible subpopulations and that they're susceptible because of these various factors, including co-exposures. But because there's this very strict paradigm to risk assessment that is very quantitatively driven, if the sort of response has been, if we can't quantify the impact of these co-exposures or stressors, so that at the end of the day, we get to a risk value, then we're just not going to be able to do much. And so there's like this weird acknowledgement that there are co-exposures, that there are these particular susceptible subpopulations, but because they they're challenged scientifically to figure out how to integrate that into their risk assessment paradigm, they sort of get stuck. Or maybe they'll say, we'll just assume there's a magnitude of uncertainty in our risk estimate or in our risk value. And so we'll just sort of divide our number by 10 or something. And we'll hopefully we're capturing, hopefully we're capturing and protecting that susceptible subpopulation. But I think we think that there's much more that can be done there, that should be done there. The law provides a pathway to do that. And I think it's sort of incumbent upon all of us, especially in the scientific community, to sort of help figure out how to integrate these sort of mixture concepts and cumulative risk concepts into the regulatory arena. And I think these talks today sort of can, in various ways, highlighted opportunities for us to sort of think through how that could be done.
Yes, thank you so much. I might toss it over to Dr. Rivera-Núñez next to see if she has any additional thoughts on maybe some technical ways in which we can take this field that might help lend to better policy. I'm sorry, Dr. Rivera-Núñez, you're hard to hear. You might be muted or have a microphone issue.
That's better. Can you hear me now? Okay. I've been listening for a long time. I was saying that, thank you for the invitation. It's very nice to be back in Michigan virtually, but it's nice. I just want to follow up to what it was said. I totally agree. I'm going to disclose, I did my postdoc at the EPA, and they struggle trying to integrate all these different exposures and how to do it in a way that it makes sense and they can move forward with it in terms of science. Then, you know, at the end, what we want, which is new regulations, and that's a struggle that they have. Then going back to some challenges in terms of lab and how can we do the measuring, right, of all these mixtures and the chemicals. One thing that I will say, it's like every day we struggle just to measure targeted chemicals that we know that they exist and they are there. So measuring things that are new or that we want to measure them together, it's, super harder. One thing that at Rutgers we have been exploring, and there is multiple projects now going on at the chemical facility there, which is directed by Brian Buckley, is the non-targeted analysis of chemicals. Unfortunately, I just say that non-targeted analysis, it's just, it's kind of exactly how it sounds. It's not the chemicals that we know that we have standards to measure. It's a relatively new technique to identify contaminants of emerging concern in relevant samples. And for us, relevant samples, or for us here, it's biological samples, right, from humans. So we can translate some of the things that we see in the toxicological data and all these wonderful studies that we just saw earlier. How can we do that and translate that in epi studies? Usually for this, for the non-targeted analysis, we use a series of computational and predicted data that we have, chemical libraries, and reference media that we have and have been created. For example, EPA has a large reference media for that. But the tricky part of this is the getting the funding to do that type of analysis and to advance the science, because NIH would not go exactly with exposure science projects, right? You can have a small piece within your aims or your sub-aims, but they will not fund a whole project where you want to move the science forward and assess these type of challenges that we have in the lab when we try to measure chemicals. So that's one thing that I'm going to say, and I'm just going to stop here so other people can talk about. But that's a real challenge and struggle that we encounter every day in the lab. So if you cannot measure them and quantify them so you can move forward and link or integrate that data to the human, to the outcome data, it's even more challenging to produce the data that you need for the risk assessment process.
Thank you. I'm gonna leave it now to Dr. Sampson to maybe talk a little bit about how we could take this particular theme of mixtures and understanding what all these mixtures are causing us in terms of health effects and expand it into our community and relating to what they're talking about and being educated with in our schools and in our general community.
Yeah, and I don't know that I need to be the last one today, but I think the topic is a nice ending topic to be thinking about, you know, the next generation and early scholars and our community partners. And so I just appreciate that as we're all grappling with the methods and the meaning of all of this. And I want to reemphasize Dr. Vandenberg's, we must persist, even if it's not perfect, approach to it. But just, you know, I work with a lot of high schoolers on a program that is high schoolers who are living on the fence line in South Dearborn and Southwest Detroit, who are living among many mixtures of these things. And so trying to think through what does that mean and how do we ground, you know, some of these discussions in terms of what is environmentally relevant, what goes into those studies or those indices, you know, I think is very real for the young people I work with. And so, you know, all the way to how do we teach undergrads about this, who are coming to me wanting recourse, who are coming to me wanting to not be paralyzed and depressed about this, but are trying to figure out in this moment in time, you know, how can they take a scientific path or is it the community organizing path? And so, you know, I think it's a really great opportunity. And we talked about windows of susceptibility, but I'd also say windows of opportunity as we come up on, you know, this fifth anniversary of TSCA's amendment, as Dr. McPartland talked about, but also, you know, we see Senator Markey and Duckworth and Representative Bush putting forward an EJ mapping policy. And so I think, you know, I think that we have to be responsive. And I've been really fortunate to actually get to work with Jyotsna in the American Public Health Association. We have just the surge of early career grad students coming in who want to work at that intersection. So they want to be part of these conversations. But, you know, we're all trying to figure out how to focus our energy on translating this into plain language for high schoolers, undergrads, the communities that we work with that don't feel like these mixture studies are necessarily representing their lived experience. And then decision makers who, you know, they may not be trained as environmental health scientists. So, you know, I think that I learned a lot in my studies, but one of the things that I am so grateful for is Tracy Woodruff and Trish Komen walking me into the EPA and teaching me how to navigate that structure, that organizational structure. And so I think really, you know, some of us might be born as lab scientists, some of us might be born as advocates and organizers, but I think we all need to be speaking those languages together somehow. And so, I'm happy to have those conversations with folks, but I realize we're up almost at time here. So I'll leave it at that.
I love that message. It's something that I take to heart kindly, and I'm going to open it up if Dr. McPartland or Dr. Rivera-Núñez, if you have anything to add to that. Otherwise, we'll take one audience question and maybe wrap up for the day here.
Or Dan. And I know if any of our speakers want to join too, please feel free. I know Laura was definitely agreeing with what you were saying before. Yes.
I just add that I enjoyed the remarks of the two panelists that followed me, and I agreed quite a bit with the points that they were making, and especially needing to sort of think about how to engage these early career scientists and public health interested students or junior professionals in this work in this space. There's so much. Sometimes it can feel fairly daunting, but there is so much to do, and there's so much that can be done and that can be done rather. And sometimes we need to be mindful of not trying to sort of eat the entire elephant at once, or let that be a distraction to making progress. I have a slightly technical question for Dr. Vandenberg, but I feel like maybe we should allow the audience to be asking the questions.
Well, I just want to, I love what Dr. Vandenberg just wrote in the chat about, can we reflect on not what is the right mixture, but really treat that as a values question instead of a scientific question. So putting that more so as a societal question, I'm thinking you're talking about, Dr. Vandenberg. I think that's a really interesting point. All right, well, if we have any other questions, I'm happy to take them, or any other comments from our panelists or speakers. I'll give a little brief hiatus here to see if anyone wants to jump in.
Well, did Dr. McPartland, did you say you had a technical question?
Yeah, well, it's not entirely technical. It's somewhere between technical and high level. But I was really fascinated by a lot of the wastewater work of produced water from oil and gas development. And we, EDF, have done some work in that space as well. And one thing that has been very evident is just the incredible variability of wastewater that's produced through unconventional oil and gas development. And I don't know if everyone's aware, but there's been increased sort of conversation, let us say, about alternative reuse of wastewater. So the vast majority of wastewater is injected in deep underground wells, but for various reasons, there's just increased interest in thinking about whether something else could be done with that wastewater. For example, irrigation, aquifer recharge in areas where there's severe drought. And in some of those conversations, just the complexity of the mixture issue and sort of characterizing the biological activity of that media, there's been sort of a discussion around sort of thinking about whether or not there could be sort of biologically based sort of standards or measurements of activity so that it's more of a biologically centric way of evaluating the water than a chemocentric way of evaluating the water, which is kind of historically the way that things are regulated, sort of like you're not allowed to have more than X concentration of chemical Y in a media, but this would be different. It'd be sort of saying like your biological activity of this wastewater or this media, and wastewater I'm just using as an example, could be anything really, where there's just such variability in chemical composition can exceed whatever it is. And I'm just wondering if you had any thoughts about thinking about creating standards along those lines that are sort of more toxicity driven rather than chemically driven, if that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
How you do that.
Yeah, I think, you know, Andreas's talk really highlighted why that would be important, that and even I think the point to take home is this is not specific to any one media, right? You heard about sludge, you heard about wastewater, you hear about, right? You hear about air, we're exposed to mixtures. And I think we have fallen into the trap of thinking, if I just avoid this chemical, everything will be fine. And we know that that's not true. So I think that what we should be doing is looking at biological outcomes, hazard, disease. I think disease is better than toxicity outcomes. And when we do that, we're going to get a more integrated measure of what harm is created by different matrices. Ultimately, it does not matter if your water bottle is leaching BPA or one of the other bisphenols, right? We keep focusing on chemical whack-a-mole, and that's why we're still playing this game. So I love the idea. I don't know how to operationalize it at a policy level, but I think we should move away from measurements of how much of X and how much of Y is there, and more focus on how much of a certain measurement of an effect is there. What a great idea.
Thank you. I think we're just about time now. And so I'm just going to take a couple minutes to wrap up and thank everyone who was involved, including all of our wonderful...
I may interrupt you a moment.
Oh, sure, Professor.
I want to add to that. I think what we need to worry about much more is what the total set of biological activity is as a result of exposure. And that is also technically challenging, but might be more illuminating in terms of the likely outcomes of those exposures. Sorry to interrupt you.
Oh, that's okay. A salient point to be made. So again, just thank you to all of our wonderful speakers and participants, as well as our attendees. And thank you to everyone here at M-LEEaD, including Dana, Vasantha, Michelle, and Robin. And of course, thank you to Deb, my lovely co-host, for making sure that she was able to cover my butt when my computer froze. So thank you all. It wouldn't be a Zoom symposium without someone having some technical difficulty. So you're welcome. And have a wonderful weekend, everyone.
Thank you all very much.